Well, I think a really, if you roll forward in time, these maps were, I think, as we hinted at earlier, were also predictive. So what you see on these maps, and you have to go into them to sort of discover that, is it's not just the four color codes. There are colored areas with hash marks, and it was a special designation. They euphemistically call it sparsely settled. So these were areas with low populations, so growth areas, and they were given a color assignment. And if you go into the details in the text and descriptions, this was really predictive. This was, we want these neighborhoods to have this future racial concentration 70 years down the road. So what these maps and the digital version are really interesting for is actually viewing them as sort of ground zero base maps, and looking at their predictive power and the impact they had down the road, which is right now in our future. And so there are a lot of interesting analyses you can do by looking at what succeeded and what didn't, the level of changes, etc., to roll it all the way back to the present. One of my colleagues in California, Jesus Hernandez, did a wonderful study putting together essentially subprime activity in 2009. So he used federal databases on those loans that flopped completely. And he layered those. He looked at the geographies of restrictive covenants, redlining, and then subprime loans. And what he came up with was absolutely stunning. Essentially, he's challenging this notion of market neutrality. He looked at Sacramento in particular. And his findings show a trajectory, sort of a compounded effect in the future, in our present, and a really strong correlation of how all these policies, not just one, but sort of this layering of policies over time, from the racialized housing credit stuff we talked about with redlining, to the 60s, 70s, and 80s redevelopment and relocation policies, to the deregulation in subprime mortgage market. So his findings indicate an absolutely strong signal, sort of a continuation. And there have been some really interesting conversations over the last few years. I was part of one in 2008 at the University of California, Santa Barbara, with lawyers at the table, actually looking at this notion, which is being rediscussed right now, debated, on remediation and on reparations. Mm. And on changing case law, in some sense, to demonstrate that the preponderance and overlapping of all these factors was so egregious and so harmful that special measures need to be taken up, and that this might be, the footprint of this redlining and its continuation in the present might be a good case study.
Well, I think what your maps do, and by the way, you can go to our website, stateofthings.org, and you can work these interactive maps and see what we're talking about for yourselves. We've got links to the maps at stateofthings.org. But what your maps show, and Nathan, your research and others show, is that this is not just the invisible hand saying, well, you know, these are not good loans because of a social thing, and we bankers didn't have anything to do with that. We're sorry, but the invisible hand dictates this. No, it's a social policy. It was a directed policy and very deliberate attempts to do these things.
Context of white supremacy. Justice Gus T. Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Wednesday, June 10th, 2015. So, I have been told. We are fundraising summer 2015. Invest if you think the program is constructive. Hopefully, the broadcast has been worthy of your time and energy. We definitely appreciate everyone who has supported us down through the years, and hope folks will continue to support us as we move forward. That being stated, our broadcast for today, I think people have commented before, folks who first start listening to the COWS, it can be very helpful to listen to the programs chronologically, just to see how the content builds as we go. Today's program, great illustration. To even give some background, I would encourage, if you want to go way back, you go all the way back to 2009 when we had Thomas Shapiro on the program. We talked about his book, The Hidden Cost of Being African American. Great information that directly relates to a lot of the things that we're going to be talking about today. One of my favorites, The Warmth of Other Suns, Isabel Wilkerson. The Great Migration, one of the main characters, Ida Mae Gladney, she migrates to Chicago. And so Isabel Wilkerson, she gives a lot of just outstanding information about the system of white supremacy in the 20th century, and particularly Chicago, since one of the main characters is there. We spent months reading the whole book and going over that. More specifically with what we're talking about today, that audio clip that you heard at the beginning, that was an interview that we played on the program from last summer with Richard Marciano and N.D.B. Connolly. Now, they were talking about the history of redlining, the Federal Housing Administration and their role in all of this, and how this has had a generational impact, generational racist impact on black people. So that was last spring. And in fact, to really be totally accurate, the program today, the book that we're going to talk about, a month before that interview, Ta-Nehisi Coates, his report on reparations in the Atlantic, it referenced our author and the book Family Properties when he was giving his extensive reasoning, deconstruction of why black people definitely are deserving of reparations for what they have endured, the terrorism that has been placed upon them. But he referenced the book we're going to talk about today, Mr. Coates, in that piece. So then the next month, you had N.D.B. Connolly, Richard Marciano doing their talk on the history of redlining, which is the same conversation. Mr. Connolly's book hadn't even come out at the time, but I knew I wanted him on the program because I thought that was such an important program, and them talking about how white people, they would have plans, 50, 60, 70 year plans about how they wanted a neighborhood to look. Do we want black people here? Maybe black people are here now, but 70 years from now, we anticipate they will not be here. And you could see how they went about making that happen. His book came out. We had him as a guest on the program this past April. His book, A World More Concrete, Real Estate and the Remaking of Jim Crow South Florida. His book, he continued to mention Andrew Kahrl, The Land Was Ours, African-American Beaches from Jim Crow to the Sun Belt South. We had Mr. Kahrl on the program in May of this year. He referenced the book we're going to talk about today, so you can see the connection between what we've been talking about and how we got here. I would only emphasize that those two guests, Andrew Kahrl and N.D.B. Connolly, two of the main points that they emphasized when they spoke with us. The first one was that white people have gotten increasingly efficient at confiscating black property, and both of them, through their book, gave information on how that is so. And then the next one, that there is a massive gap in information in terms of what black people understand about what's going to be happening, and in terms of when they know things. Sometimes black people find out that things are going to happen the next day, 24 hours, where you have white people who knew this information sometimes a month ago, sometimes a year ago, sometimes 5 years ago. But massive gap in information that happens under the system of white supremacy. But those were two of the main points, and I think those play out in this book as well as just the overall huge point that racists have made abusing black people one of the most profitable industries on the planet. I think that'll be evidenced in our text for today. Our guest, she is a historian at Rutgers University in New Jersey. Her research was rewarded with a 2015 Guggenheim Grant. The book that we're going to discuss today, Family Properties, Race, Real Estate, and the Exploitation of Black Urban America. I guarantee you, if you read those three books, A World More Concrete, The Land Was Ours, Family Property, your IQ and understanding of racism will make a quantum leap if you read those three books together. Excellent material. Excited to get to it. Our guest joining us live, Dr. Beryl Satter. Dr. Satter, are you with us?
Hello?
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Loud and clear.
Oh, great, great, great. No, there was something said unmuted, so I didn't know what that was. Hi, and thank you for inviting me. I'm delighted to be on your show.
Oh, the pleasure is ours. We are excited to have you. For folks, this might be their first time hearing about your book, hearing about the work that you do. Anything that you think would be helpful for listeners to know about you before we get started?
Well, I think what I could explain is where my book sits with the other scholars that you've had on already, who are a fabulous group. What many of them talk about is how redlining, which was the denial of mortgage loans to black people, irregardless of their credit history, of their individual credit worthiness, how that damaged black communities and drained wealth from black communities. And what my book, Family Properties, was about was the specific mechanisms by which the drain of wealth out of black communities occurred in Chicago from the 50s through about the 70s, which was a really crucial period. It's the period of the Second Great Migration that Isabel Wilkerson describes. So I think what my book does is provide a piece of a larger puzzle and a very important piece of that as to how, again, the precise mechanisms. And what my book answers, the mystery that it fills in, is something that people have known for a long time, which is that in Chicago and across the nation, neighborhoods changed from white to black very quickly, urban neighborhoods, sometimes, you know, within 6 months. They would go from all white to all black. And this happened, again, mid-20th century. And people know at the same time that white people tended to sell their property low and leave and go to the suburbs where they can get a fairly good deal with a low down payment, but that black people moving in bought high, paid high prices for their properties. But what isn't clear is, given redlining, given that black people could not get mortgages from banks, how could they buy high? How could they pay high prices for properties, given that they couldn't get the bank loans? And what I talk about in Family Properties is the mechanism by which they did were able to buy high, which was through very, very predatory credit arrangements that were incredibly common in Chicago. And so what I describe is the system of contract selling. And Ta-Nehisi Coates discusses this as well. He uses the contract selling scheme that I talk about in my book as a frame for the larger argument for reparations. And I think it's an extremely appropriate frame. So if you'd like, I could explain how contract selling worked and how it drained wealth from black communities. Should I go ahead and do that?
Well, just before you hop into that, because I definitely do want to get that as well, but just really quick for listeners who have not seen you, you are a white woman, is that correct?
Yes, I am Jewish. My father was a Jewish attorney. He was born in 1916, and the way I learned about these exploitative schemes that happened in mid-century was because my father, as an attorney, fought these schemes, often fighting fellow white attorneys because many attorneys were in on this scheme. And he had a social consciousness. He came of age during the Great Depression. And when black people began moving into the neighborhood that he lived in, which was Lawndale on the west side of Chicago, actually West Garfield Park, he was raised in Lawndale, but as an adult raising his own family, he had moved to West Garfield Park. He saw the new black people moving in as working class people of a similar origin as his own, which was a working class background. And so it's through my father's social consciousness and his desire as an attorney to help other working people who were being exploited, whether they were black or white, it's through his work and his papers that I learned this story. So, so I do think actually that my white Jewish background does matter because it's the neighborhood that I write about in Family Properties is Lawndale, the west side, which is formerly heavily Jewish and then became black. And the story of that transition is a tragic one, not so different from transitions of other white ethnic communities to black communities, but this is one to which I have a personal connection.
Before we get into the details of what this contract selling was all about, on this program, we try to make sure we ask every one of our guests the definition for the term racism. I think that's very important when discussing these type of issues. The definition that I use for the term racism, first I use that term as a synonym with white supremacy, and then I use the same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think that definition is accurate? Do you think such a system exists?
Yeah, I don't think there's any question that white supremacy exists and that white supremacy works hand in hand with capitalism to make huge profits for a white-dominated nation in this case. I mean, I think racism is somewhat complicated in majority black cultures where it exists in certain respects, not indigenously, I don't think, but imported. But nevertheless, I wouldn't ever question that such a system exists. It's a complicated system, and it's a system that modifies to local circumstances. But what it does do is classify certain people as inferior, denying them rights in complicated ways, and then making use of that denial of often political rights to extract huge amounts of wealth. I think that's how I would define it.
I said that at the top. This system has made abusing black people one of the most lucrative enterprises on the planet. I think your book is a great demonstration of that. I wanted to, two quick ones before we get into the details of your book. Number one, I've been trying to ask every white person I can this to just get a sense of what they think. Mr. Coates, he writes a lot of stuff for The Atlantic and other places too. In December, man, whoo, I am throwing, if I can use a basketball metaphor, I am passing the ball to myself like 30 minutes in advance. So I'm going to catch this like 30 minutes later, but just hang tight. So Mr. Coates, he wrote a piece in December, and in that piece, he was talking about racism, and he got to a point and he said, white people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism, but rarely are they pained enough. And I got to the first part of the sentence and I said, man, I've got to ask some white people to see if they think this is true. As a white person, given your research, the white people you've been around that you know, your observation as a historian, do you think your understanding of white people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism? Do you think that's an accurate statement?
Well, sadly, it might not be. I think the way racism functions for many white people is to justify the life they lead and to make them feel that they deserve the, the benefits that they accrue. So I don't, some are greatly pained, but many, that takes a certain amount of knowledge. Many don't have that knowledge. So I think without an educational effort to enlighten white people and all people, really, as to precisely how, especially the economics of racism function, they will fall back on the comforting assumption that people who have less are simply inferior to them, and the fact that systematically people, black people, deemed non-white have less, it's their own fault. So that's, I think, probably at this point in this country, a majority. I think there's a minority who feel bad about it because they recognize a certain level of injustice, and then an even smaller minority that fully understand the mechanisms of racism, or at least have a significant understanding of it, and understand that it's something to be fought both because of justice and because an unjust social situation damages an entire society. Morally as well as materially.
Okay. The latter portion in terms of white people not being informed about the machinations of racism that I categorically reject. And I'm actually, man, woo, I just read your book over the past week. Wow, lots of details there that I will be using in the future when people say that, because that's one that I think that's one of the big reasons that we haven't made more progress in dealing with racism mm-hmm. is because people keep repeating that lie that part of this problem is that white people are just not informed. But we'll get to that.
Well, they don't want to be. I mean, I think that
all manifestations yeah. of the way that that's packaged, that they don't want to be, that it's willful, all of that is poppycock, in my opinion. And as I said, we will get to that as we roll, just picking out things from your book. But the first part, I don't want to miss the first part about Mr. Coates' statement about white people being greatly pained, because that's important, because I too think that that statement is false. And now the majority of white people that we've asked on this program have also said that they think it's false. And I think that's very important, because I think, and again, I go to your book. I think that's also one of the problems. We greatly greatly exaggerate the amount of empathy that white people have about all of this. I think that also is a big problem. I think you have a lot of white people. It's not that they're ignorant. They just don't care if whatever happens mm-hmm. to black people, children, adults, whatever. If it's happening to black people, so what? The world would be better off if there were fewer of them here anyway. That's just the general attitude that is created in the system of white supremacy. And that's unfortunately par for the course in terms of the white collective. And I think your book, great illustration of that repeatedly over and over and over. It's not as crude as that, but that's the general sense of it. The other quick question I wanted to get, and then we'll get the details of your text. Who was your target audience? And I ask that because I've seen some of the talks that you've given, and it looked like it was a lot of white people. And I wasn't surprised about that or angry about that. It reminded me, Isabel Wilkerson, similar topic. I've seen a lot of her talks, and it was a lot of white people. I know some black people have read the book. I'm one of them. I've talked to other black people who've read it, but I get a sense that it's a lot. It might even be majority white people who are reading these books. Who is your target audience? Who do you get a sense of who's reading your book?
Well, you asked me who I wrote it for or who was actually reading it.
Both.
It's a little different.
Both.
Well, you know, I kind of wrote it for myself, to be honest. I wanted to understand these things. I spent 9 years researching and writing this book, and I worked all the time on it. I mean, I had a full-time teaching job as well, so every second that was free, I was working on this book. So I worked on it. My target audience was, in some ways, was for me to have an understanding of what happened to my family, what happened to my city. Once I started reading these old press accounts about the exploitation of black homebuyers, I realized I don't see this other places. I don't see this sort of analysis. I hadn't been raised with it, I knew about vicious racism in the past, going maybe through the 1940s, but I didn't really know the more recent stuff. And I'm a historian, so I thought, as I started reading the sources, I was shocked and angered and intrigued and felt I needed to understand this in as thorough a manner as I possibly could. And I decided to write it as clearly as I could. I am a historian. I'm an academic. But I decided to write this thing in a non-academic way, to write it in a way that as many people as possible could read it. And I wasn't honestly thinking in terms of black or white when I wrote it. I was really just thinking in terms of clarity. It has to be clear. And it had to be clear, first of all, to me, as someone who isn't really terribly good at economics. So it was a challenge. And as far as who was actually reading it, I think, I think it's been taught in a lot of schools. I have spoken to black audiences as well as white audiences. They're not always the ones that are recorded. Sometimes black audiences get irritated that as a white person I'm giving them this information. They feel like, here we go again, another white person coming in and telling us stuff. But sometimes they are really interested in what I have to say. So, that's it's been a mix, in short.
Okay. To the book, Family Properties. You've already given us some of the background about how your father, attorney, influenced you to kind of go back and look at his record and what he was doing for some of the black people that were struggling and having a tough time in Chicago, where he became more informed about what was happening with this contract situation. And that's kind of what spurred you to write this, just to give some of the details. In fact, I'll read a little bit from the book. Before I turn it over, I will just encourage folks to keep in mind what I said about white people being ignorant about racism. So as you hear some of these anecdotes, keep that in mind. If these white people sound like they are ignorant, that they don't know what racism is and how it works and what they're supposed to be doing as a white person to make sure that all of this happens. So this is, and I have the Kindle, just also FYI, I have the Kindle version, so my page numbers might not correspond if people are checking for the hard paper copy. But at any rate, for me, it's page 68, where you write, "My father was right that the speculators he took to court had warped every aspect of this code. They misled their clients, fostered the decline of property values, and sold properties on terms that made home ownership almost impossible. He failed to understand that the city's white professional class saw his clients as an entirely outside the bounds of ethical consideration. In the white-dominated fields of real estate, law, and banking, professional ethics applied to whites only. And in this context, the treatment that his black clients received broke no rules at all." Now, with that backdrop, give us the details, since this is no rules apply. What is this contract selling? How does it work? And if you can give us kind of an illustration so folks can make it concrete.
Okay. Oh, that's great that you read that quote. It's a powerful quote, and it's totally, you're right. I mean, especially in the 1950s when, which is the period that refers to, my father noted that, when you read about, I'm sorry, I just got distracted. When you, real estate agents overtly said that our job is to protect white people. You know, there are many interviews and quotes with them where they said, well, of course, our job is to make sure that the white neighborhoods stay good. So they were very overt. But as far as the particular contract selling scheme that my father wrote about and that I wrote about, the way it worked was that there was a desperate housing shortage as more and more black people moved north. And a lot of the people who were moving north in the 40s and 50s, they came north, African Americans came north to get jobs. And they did have jobs and they did have an income. So the idea that they were just poor when they came and just stayed poor is a myth, too. But what they couldn't do is get housing because of overt white policies by whites to keep white people out of the suburbs, first of all, and then within the city to not give them loans to buy properties there if they wanted to. And so you had a huge demand for housing by blacks, and you had a supply of housing as white people were leaving the city to go to the suburbs. But what was missing was a mechanism to transfer that housing from departing whites to home-hungry black people. And the people who came in to broker that switch were real estate brokers and attorneys and the white professional class, bankers, attorneys, and real estate agents, who together realized that they could sell housing to black people, not with a mortgage, but on an installment plan. And that's what contract selling was. It was selling the house on an installment plan. And what they would do, real estate agents would buy up properties from departing whites at up close to market value. So say a house was worth $8,000, they'd buy it for $7,500, something close, sometimes even a little more than market value, but, you know, usually a little bit less, and then turn it around and sell it on installments, that is on contract, to a black buyer, and mark it up double to quadruple. So if it was an $8,000 house, they'd sell it for $16,000 to $24,000. And this was routine in the 50s. This was outrageous markups. And the way they would sell it was even worse, because they sold it where you had to make a down payment for a contract sale, an installment sale. you had to make a down payment on the house, just like you would for a regular mortgage. You had to pay taxes on the house, just like you would on a mortgage. You had to pay insurance and interest. But what you couldn't get was any equity in the house. So you would pay and pay and pay. But if you missed one payment, you would lose the house. And it would go back to the person who's a real estate agent who had sold it to you. So it had all of the dangers of renting and all the disadvantages of buying combined. And because the prices were marked up to double to quadruple what they should have been, it would be easy to miss a payment because your monthly payments were so inflated. So that was how property changed hands, because blacks didn't get mortgages, so they had to buy this way. And everyone, as you read that piece, people were in on this scheme. Property inspectors knew about it. Real estate agents knew about it. Attorneys were very involved with it, which made my father unusual when he called out fellow attorneys and said, wait, you shouldn't be selling your own clients' properties at quadruple their value and then taking the property back when they miss one. You know, he was then attacked for daring to challenge a brother attorney. It was a widely known system. And my father estimated that in 1958, this system, by charging so much more to blacks and by giving them such harsh terms on their purchases, that it was draining $1 million a day from black Chicago. And in today's money, that would be $8 million a day. And that statistic has not really been challenged. There were approximately 800,000 black people in Chicago in the late 50s. It moved up to over a million by the early 60s. And of those people, about 75 to 80%, when they bought properties, bought in this manner on contract, in this incredibly risky way, where you couldn't make a mistake. And if you did make a mistake and missed one payment, everything was gone. So that was a brutal system. And part of it was just the economics of it were so lopsided and the risks were so great. But what the system also did was, because the risks were so high of if you missed one payment, you lost your house, people who bought on contract had to make those payments, and so they couldn't put any money out for maintenance of their properties. They had to squeeze in extra tenants if they were going to make that payment. If a husband was working, he had to take a second job to make the payments. If he was already working two jobs, his wife had to take a job too. And all these things that they were doing, working, double shifts so that they could make their payments, packing the house so that they could make their payments, not doing maintenance so they can make their payments, all those things led to the decline of the neighborhoods where they had moved, paying top dollar with high hopes of improving their lot. And that was the sort of sickening tragedy of it, was that these were people who had the money, who had the dream, who wanted to move to a better area with, bigger houses and better options for their children. And then they ended up, because of the terms of the purchase were so rough, they ended up, bringing decline with them through no fault of their own, but because of the ridiculously harsh financing terms to which they were subjected. And then the rest of the city points to them and says, what's wrong with you? You're overcrowding your property. You don't do any maintenance. Why aren't the parents at home? Why are the kids running wild? All these things to blame the victims. And that's when the idea that white people are ignorant of it, for many whites who weren't in on the schemes personally, all they saw were the effects. They didn't always know the causes. If you were a real estate agent, you knew the cause. If you were someone personally profiting, you knew what was going on. But if you're just some white guy who sold your house to move to the suburbs, and then you went back to the old neighborhood and said, oh, my God, what happened to this neighborhood? For them, they just said, it must be the people. It must be them. And that was what my father tried to do in the late 50s and 60s, was tell them, no, it's not the people. It's the procedures to which they are subjected. It's the economic policies that are so vicious that are destroying them and destroying their communities. And nothing is going to stop it except, giving them fair terms and fair prices and treating them like you, as if there wasn't white supremacy. And that's what he said, and that's, what the point of my book was, to lay out again, how these procedures operated in the hopes of enlightening people so that they don't blame the victims of these procedures, instead understand the procedures that victimize a minority population, in this case, Chicago African Americans.
Fantastic. I hope folks don't miss all of that with these contract sellings, the markups, double, even quadruple the actual value of the property. And a lot of times, no repairs. They're not keeping up maintenance. It's in violation of housing codes in the city. Fire trap, I mean, just horrible all the way around. And then you're getting fleeced. If you miss a payment, you can lose everything. Your down payment, doesn't matter how many payments you've made, how long you've lived there, you can lose it all, just be evicted and nothing. But back to the ignorance. I'm sorry?
No protection at all. No protection at all. And I just want to say, like, I had my father's legal cases, and he had cases, he had clients who had paid off $8,500 out of a $9,000 house that they paid $9,000 for, but that the speculator bought for $3,000. They paid almost the entire thing and then missed one payment or manipulated into missing a payment, and they lose the house. I mean, it's so extreme, it's almost hard to imagine. But I just wanted to give that concrete example.
Wow. The only point of contention that I would raise is the ignorance. In my view, I bring up that proverb that we were talking about laughter, too. We've had a little bit of laughter today as well. The point I would bring up is that, in my view, being intelligent, you're a historian, being a scholar, you want to make sure that we're using correct terms to describe what it is that we're talking about. If I'm ignorant about mathematics, right, I don't know algebra, and you come, you bring me a book, we sit down, we go over it, we study it, now I got it. Okay, I'm clicking, and it's visible. I can do algebra. I can solve the equation. X is, boom, I'm clicking. If I'm ignorant about racism, and you come and you tell me, oh, okay, we're cheating these black people, and they can't get loans, and the FHA is in on this, and these people are scheming them and taking all this money, and blah, 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 and you come and tell me all this, and I get this information, if I continue to go out and do the same thing, you can't really say that I am ignorant, that the problem is that I don't know that this is happening to black people. And I contend that is not even close to the reality of what this situation is with white people. They don't have to know all the intricacies and ins and outs of contract sales or subprime loans or sharecropping, whatever era we happen to be in. The end of the day, I think most white people, they are very aware. Black people are supposed to be getting fleeced. Whatever it is, however it works, the end result, black people, mistreatment. That's what's supposed to be happening. And I would just, again, we go back to the book. This is on page 95, where you write, you're talking about the Hargrove. Some of these stories are just, I read the book, I think about every other page, my chin was just on the ground reading some of these stories of what happened to these black people. But you write, the Hargroves had been displaced from their previous home by the city's land clearance office and hope to start a new life with their four children in Lawndale. Instead, menacing white crowds gathered in front of their building for four nights in a row. On the worst night, 500 police confronted a mob of 4,000 rock and bottle throwing whites. The real estate dealer who expedited the contract sale, Harry Gaynor, who was also threatened repeatedly. I hope you remember what happened to Mel Kaur, so you be prepared. An anonymous writer threatened. The reference was to Mario Melchior, who had been murdered 3 weeks earlier. Rumor had it, he'd been killed for selling to blacks in a white neighborhood. Now, I'm actually even going to dig and give folks the footnote on this one. The note continued, for a few lousy dollars commission, you devaluate every building on our block. For four of us property owners have pledged to get even with you, even if it costs our lives. As for that nigger who bought this place, we will see how much guts he has when we start working on him. Now, I have another anecdote, but just before I get to that one, I would just say, now you can come to your own conclusion if you think this is a reasonable response for someone who's upset about property values or, you know, I paid $20,000 for my home and now I maybe only get $15,000 or $12,000. If this is a reasonable response, and or if these white people sound like they are ignorant, the problem is that they don't know that these black people are being mistreated and that this is wrong and that we should be trying to remedy this somehow. One of the next anecdotes before I give you an opportunity, if you'd like to respond. There's so many, I feel like I could just flip
them. Sure. I mean, the book is full of these stories, and the point is to shock people and let them see how bad it really was. But I would say that there were some white people who did learn about what was behind the way it was working was that these riots happened, and the white liberal interpretation of the riots was that white working class people, who tended to be the one who rioted, were primitive and had psychological problems and rioted and acted in this vicious way because they just didn't understand that people are people. That's the way white liberals, more well-to-do whites, did. And what I think is going on, I don't think it's a reasonable response. I don't in any way obviously condone the mobs. But what my father argued, and what I think I try to argue in the book, is that these are people who saw decay happening, and they didn't know what it was caused by, and they thought it had something to do with how black people were rather than what was being done to them. And there were, as people began to understand through, in part, the publicity that my father generated and many people at the Chicago Daily News and the Chicago Defender and the Courier and some of the black newspapers were writing about the schemes that black people were subjected to, some people began to say, white and black, that what we need is to create banks and loan opportunities and, you know, challenge the economic exclusion and exploitation of black Americans. And there were some whites who went along with that and even pioneered in some of the efforts to pump capital back to black communities. I'm thinking of specifically Shore Bank, South Shore Bank, which had a racially mixed leadership and which emerged in the early 70s specifically to fight the kind of viciousness and ignorance that whites who rioted when blacks moved in showed, because their idea was if the neighborhoods don't decline when black people move in, then the whites will chill out. You know, they'll realize then that their livelihood is not at stake, that that there's a bigger process that's screwing everyone, and maybe it would be better to understand it and stand together. Gail Sincotta in Austin and the NPA, National People's Alliance, something like that. There were certain groups that did make some hard fights. They were responsible for things like the Community Reinvestment Act and the Home Mortgage Disclosure Act, which were passed in the mid-70s to fight the redlining of black communities and to force banks to admit where they were loaning and where they weren't, and then to force them to reinvest in places where they took deposits. So, you know, I mean, I totally understand what you're saying. I mean, you're using my book to make your point. So it's certainly clear that there's a lot of vicious and overt racism. But I guess I would say that what those very vicious people are saying, I don't think they think that, I think it's not so much that they think black people are there to be fleeced. They think that black people don't have the ability not to be hurt, that they need to understand that they themselves could never survive under the kind of conditions and the kind of policies that black people have been subjected to, and stop congratulating themselves, because the way racism works is that they just think they're superior rather than that they're getting benefits every step of the way. And that's what if they were aware that they were being treated, you know, that they were being given a completely different standard, it would take away their sense of superiority, and they would realize that they were, you know, that it was a cheating situation, and that would undercut their pride and their sense of ownership of, what goods they have. So that's where I differ from you. But, I mean, I understand what you're saying, and again, I give plenty of evidence to support your perspective as well in my book.
Right. Certainly. I would just, again, in my opinion, everything that you just gave out, it is a gross minimization of collective white pathology. There are too many white people, even too many white people in your book. Even if we push the mob to the side for the second, nobody can say that the white people at the FHA, that they don't know what's happening. Oh, they're very aware. The contract sellers, they're very aware. Even pops up in the book where some of these contracts, and I was even pulling back because you didn't express it this way, but for me, I'm saying we're in a total system of white supremacy. Even if we say, okay, the contract sellers, these white people are bad, what they're doing and taking all this money from black people and having them in these horrendous conditions. Okay, even if we say that, and some of the contract sellers point out along the way in the book, wait a minute, you all are acting like we are the only white people that are mistreating black people. If we were really going to pull out and address this, it reminds me of the film The Intruder, where there's, again, a white mob comes to attack two black people. And the sheriff arrives and they say, okay, you've got to arrest someone. And so the sheriff looks, it's hundreds of white people who have mobbed two black people. And he says, well, am I supposed to arrest the whole town? And everybody goes home. That's what it reminded me of. Like, eventually, like, well, wait a minute. If we're going to get the contract sellers, you would have to get the FHA and probably Mayor Daley. And I don't know who would be excluded from this. You would have to go after almost every white person
is
culpable in some degree. So, I mean, it's just, it's nonsense to even try and make these arguments to find a good white person that's just not representative of the collective white pathology and why you keep seeing the same repetition of these gross terroristic. In fact, I will just stop and go to your chapter title, because one of my contentions, and I hope people read these texts, it will recalibrate the way that you think of terrorism. I've said before, we should equate racism with terrorism, because that's what it is. It's the greatest form of terrorism on this planet, what is done against non-white people, especially black people. And I've said that, and some people have jumped back. A lot of our white guests, oh my God, that's just inflammatory rhetoric. You titled the second chapter in your book, A Noose Around the Neck of Black Chicago. And I said, now that metaphor right there to me suggests that this is terrorism. Why did you choose that metaphor? And do you think what was happening with these contract sales is that terrorism against black people, economic terrorism?
I think it is. And I also think that this history of white mob violence against blacks is never anywhere near as publicized as whenever black people riot. You know, there's national commissions and there's all kinds of efforts to figure out, you know, what happened, why did they do this, and there's all this press and publicity. But for a good 20 years at least, white people rioted quite regularly to stop black people from moving to their communities, and it's completely covered up. Only some historians seem to know about it. I mean, it's in a few books. And it was actually consciously covered up, as I describe in the book, because white authorities were afraid, so they said they were afraid of copycat riots by other whites. So they told media people not to write about these riots, and only occasionally did they slip into the broader newspaper culture. But the fact that we don't know about kids aren't taught in school about white violence and only about black rioters is part of the, it's a piece of the larger story of demonizing black people and contributing to white supremacy. And that's why I have to say, I think the move to, recently in Chicago to make the story of the police officer Burge, who was doing torture for 20 years, to not only give money to the victims of his crimes, but to insist that the story of what happened be taught in the schools, I think they're very helpful. So I don't know. I mean, it goes back and forth. I think there aren't many white people who understand white supremacy. I think way more benefit from it than care to understand its mechanisms. I guess, you know, the crux of our disagreement is on whether you can be every bit as racist without understanding precisely how it works, or do you have to really understand how it works? And I think it could go either way. I think plenty of people are only see the results of racism in their suburban enclaves where they live, where they never, you know, encounter or do their best to not encounter black people. And others who are in the midst of it and thoroughly understand what's going on. And both of them are part of the problem of white supremacy. So I think I'm splitting the difference with you on this. I know you're firm on your position, so you don't need to take me on more if you like. It's up to you.
Right. Thank you.
The distinction. Yeah.
No. It more laughter. More laughter. That's significant as well. I would only say, even if I did entertain that argument, which I can again only insist in my view, I tell a lot of the white guests when they make that point, I suspect that is a deliberate act of racism. Because as I said before, I'm of the opinion that's one of the major reasons why we haven't made more progress. Thinking, implying, suggesting that the problem is that white people are poorly informed about racism. That just is not so. But even if I did stop for a minute and entertain that could be true, I haven't seen any evidence that giving white people information about racism stops them from practicing racism. So either way, it is all nonsense, all I can say.
Hang on, because I did want to
make sure I try to get as much info out of the book as possible. We have time for the ignorant thing. One of the very important characters in this book, and very important people, not a character, Dempsey J. Travis. He pops up recurringly through the text. He has a lot of great quotes. I'll give one just because I think this is so important. It's been my opinion. I hear a lot of people who criticize and chastise black people and say, man, black people are ridiculous. They will get a car and they won't get a house. And you need to have land. Mm-hmm. And I can't believe that, being so financially illiterate. And it's like, again, we are greatly minimizing the hand that white people have had and why that is, that black people don't have as much land and why you see a lot more black people that go to vehicles. Mr. Dempsey J. Travis, in your book on page 141, he says, Mr. Travis understood this refusal of credit to African-American home buyers in the broadest terms. Within the system, there is a willingness to lend you all you need to buy a car, he told an interviewer. A car can't appreciate. When you want to buy a house, however, you get only a big frown. The houses represent a method of capital appreciation in the ghetto community, and a strong capital base is a threat to the white community. Can you give us some more details about Dempsey J. Travis?
Sure. He passed away just a few years ago. He was a mortgage broker who came up during a period when it was incredibly difficult to be a black mortgage broker and black mortgage banker. The American Mortgage Association was a segregated society. It was all white. They wouldn't let black people in the 40s and 50s when he was trying to get himself started in this career, which means that he couldn't go to the professional associations. He couldn't, he just didn't get any of the benefits of the kind of information that they shared among themselves. So he struggled from the outside to become a mortgage broker and a mortgage banker. And something that when I do talk to white audiences actually about my book, sometimes they'll say, well, why don't they just create their own banks? What's the problem? You know, why, they'll say that about black people. Can't white people create banks? Why don't they create banks? And the story of Dempsey Travis and how he tried to create a bank and create some body of capital to loan to black people on fair terms is a case study in why that was so hard. You know, he was continually excluded from the kinds of organizations that would have given him access to capital. But, you know, he worked 10 times as hard, and he, you know, managed eventually to create the company that he created. And he ended up helping negotiate some of these, helping people get out of some of these exploitative contract sales. So he's just an example of someone who was superlatively talented and incredibly hardworking and managed to do have some achievements over incredibly difficult odds, but it's sort of the exception that proves the rule of how hard it is to do what he did. He's a fascinating character, and he went on to write a number of books about Black Chicago and about a number of other topics, including jazz and things like that. So he has a book called An Autobiography of Black Chicago. He has a book called An Autobiography of Black Politics. He's a fascinating person, and I hope your readers, your listeners get a chance to check out some of his writing.
Man, Dempsey J. Travis, adding that to my reading list. Definitely, folks in Chicago, you should do some research. I know we have Black Chicago listeners. Before we get to the contract buyers league or contract buyers of Lawndale, I guess that was first name and then switching. You talk about how a lot of these slumlords, the contract sellers, they didn't keep up maintenance. It was kind of known that housing codes were not enforced in black neighborhoods. Like this is one that white people cannot say they were ignorant about. This is in the newspaper. Like, of course we don't enforce code violations in black neighborhoods. We'd have to tear down half the properties, if not more, and all these people would be homeless. So you can even say it as though it was benevolent, like we're doing this so that we don't toss all these black people out in the street. But not doing this means that we already know that there are going to be a lot of incidents like what you write about on page 59 on January 20th. Luana Walker was awakened From a deep sleep, by heat and smoke, she grabbed her baby daughter, Stephanie, and ran to the bedroom door, but her way was blocked by flames. She set Stephanie down in order to break a window. When she turned to pick her up, the baby had vanished in the thick black smoke. A neighbor outside cried, "Throw me the baby, throw me the baby." But I couldn't find Stephanie. She must have crawled away, a hysterical Walker told reporters. Walker survived with severe burns on her face. Stephanie and three adults in the building, Herman McNeil, his wife Virginia, and Virginia's brother Robert Gilliard, were consumed by flames. An investigation revealed the full dimensions of the tragedy. The fire had broken out in a once elegant Southside mansion that had been converted into a rooming house. The building's third floor, a space originally designed as a ballroom, had been partitioned into five small apartments divided by a locked door into two main sections. This door blocked the McNeil Gilliard family's efforts to escape the flames via a rear stairway. No permit had been filed for converting the third floor into apartments. In fact, such a permit would surely have been denied since the front part of the space had no fire exit. This is one more case where money has been put ahead of human lives, Chicago's coroner Walter E. McCarran commented. Then, on January 23rd, another apartment house, this one located just blocks away, erupted into flames. The building had been constructed in 1884 as an 8-flat, but had been cut up into 27 apartments. 7 children were killed. 4 days later, yet another fire broke out in a nearby basement apartment. 2 children suffocated to death. Just for the context, because you do give details about, it's not just, okay, yeah, you got the contracts and these just wretched death trap apartments, residences. You've also got gouged insurance prices, high goods, just the entire environment that Black people live in is kind of representative of this horrendous episode of all these children being burned and choking to death in flames. Can you add some of the context of these environments of exploitation of Black people?
Okay. Those are tragic stories, and a line that continues in one of the newspaper accounts, they say this was carnage even by Chicago standards. So what's happening here is that the migrants, the same generation that Isabel Wilkerson writes about, the people who moved to Chicago looking for a better life, come north, and as you just said, they get fleeced pretty much every which way they turn. And many of them were coming from southern Mississippi communities where the racism was extremely overt, where, you know, you had to say sir and ma'am, and you had to, behave, have certain behavioral traits when you were in the presence of a white person and all that. And they come north and it seems so much better. No one's really bugging them on a personal level. But what's happening is it's all sort of happening in a slightly more subtle level where they just don't understand why they're ending up paying, more for furniture, more for housing, more for groceries, more for insurance, pretty much anything you want to name. Given that you have segregation, which is violently enforced and legally enforced by the white mobs, as we mentioned before, and then also through bank policies that won't loan to Blacks, and, of course, real estate agents who will not show Black people homes in white neighborhoods, all that combines to funnel Blacks into overcrowded areas where they already had been turned over, more or less, to them in the what was then called the Black Belt on the South Side. So the Black population in the Black Belt, that is the South Side of Chicago, as it was termed in those days, went from something about 280,000 people in 1940 to almost 1 million in the early 60s. And to have quadrupling the population in a very small area, and then you have restrictive codes and white mobs and banking policies keeping them in those areas, that led to the cutting up of the apartments. That led to, such desperation for housing, and the people who own those properties knew they could make a killing by subdividing them. And so that led, in turn, to these fires, where you had rigged up cooking facilities and rigged up heating and things like that, because these apartments were not intended to be 27 flats. They were intended to be 8 flats. And the end of the line were these fires, which were so brutal and led to the deaths of men, women, and children.
Wow.
So there was a bunch of these fires in the late 50s, and it made the press. And as you say, one of the things that the discussion in the press was about cult violations. Well, how come they weren't stopped? Why were they allowed to cut up these apartments and violate all these building codes? And as you say, as I report, the newspapers. Response was, well, if we didn't enforce the building codes, there wouldn't be enough housing for black people. What they won't say is, obviously, they need to have free access to the city as any other citizen of the city should have. But instead of saying that, the answer was, well, we'll just ignore the code violations. And then when there's a tragedy like a fire, you know, everyone has to say this is a tragedy, but we won't acknowledge what the answer should be, which is freedom of movement and equal access to credit, which is what they don't have.
That, and see, that's where I say this is, it's not ignorance, because this is one I think we would both have to, I guess on your part, it might be a begrudging acknowledgement that this is not about white ignorance with this part right here. Everyone knows this. This, as you said, this is in the newspaper. This is common knowledge that codes are not enforced in black areas. So in my opinion, it's not a, well, we'll just wait for the fire to happen every other day and then say, oh, this is a tragedy. It is. It goes back to that passage that we started with. Black people are not thought of as human life. So whatever happens to them, moving forward, you just don't have the same empathy. I can even skip forward and get the quote that you pulled from the juror later on when you get into some of these legal battles with the Contract Buyers League. And this white juror is just like, yeah. I just didn't sympathize with them, and I was just trying to correct all of this nonsense that we've been dealing with since Brown versus Board of Education, and just moving forward. White people just do not empathize with, do not regard black people as human life worthy of justice. That's why you can have this sort of thing happen all the time, unless I'm in error.
But I have to say, I guess I'll ask you, do you think there's any point in white people reading my book? Because the white people who have read it have expressed to me anyway that they learned a lot and that this was, that they didn't understand it in this kind of detail. And now that they do understand it, they want to do something about it. It's a minority, but I do see that. So do you think white people should not read my book? It's sort of useless, or what do you think?
I would encourage black people to read this text, which is even kind of rare, because most of the time I do not encourage folks to read books that white people have written about racism, because generally they're not accurate. But I would say this one has a lot of great information. I don't agree with everything. I certainly do not agree that white people are ignorant about racism. But I think even with that, you read the book, and I think it's there. If you can read and process, it's right there that clearly that is not the case, that white people are not ignorant. They're very informed. They just have no regard for black life. And that's how you can see this manifested, even up with the pool thing I was going to read. I'll pause to see if folks have questions they would like to ask. I'll give the number out. But with the pool incident that everyone has been talking about down in Texas, where I've been saying for about a year now, this is a whole body of research, brawls over black people getting access to pools. That's a thesis, a dissertation. There are books that have already been written about that. And then lo and behold, the riot in the 60s, one of the riots that happened in Chicago in the 60s, group of black children playing in a fire hydrant, and the police come and then things roll out of hand. It happens all the time. If folks have questions that they would like to get in, the number 760-569-7676, and the code is 564-943-pound. Press *6 if you would like to participate. Again, I would say black people. I would encourage black people to read the book. I think they can learn something. They can learn a lot about white people. And definitely, if you're a black person in Chicago, you should definitely read this book, as well as some of the others that were referenced. I think it'll give you a lot of great information. Before I get my call, given you give a lot of detail about your family and your father and his death at a young age, how that impacted your family and what have you, and spurred later on you writing this book, as I read everything, processed what happened to your father, to me, it looked like a great illustration, kind of the way that I pointed Viola Luiso and the two white boys that died in Mississippi with James Chaney. And there are a few other examples, not many. James Reeb, they were just talking about him with Selma, Reverend James Reeb. I looked at your father as an example of this is what happens if you are a white person and you don't go with the racist code. This is what can happen to you. Does that? What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think that's what it shows. It's very, very hard to buck that tide. And when you do, there's a price to be paid. There, on the other hand, there's a great amount of dignity to be earned by doing so. But yeah, I think it is. He by refusing to go along, he suffered an immense amount of stress, couldn't support his family, and died young. So I think you're right. It is a small number, but they're significant anyway. Mm-hmm. They tell you how tough it is and what strength it does take to try to fight back against this white supremacist culture.
Hmm. I see a lot of folks with hands. I'll try to nab as many callers as we can. Thomas in Perth, I guess if we have Chicago listeners, I know we have folks in Chicago. Y'all should get a hand up, ask a question. If you heard about this book, people talking about this, anything for folks who are Chicago residents, certainly dial in. Thomas in New York, did you have a question for Dr. Beryl Satter? Your line should be open.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Hey, how are you today, Gus? How are you, guest? To your guest, Ms. Satter.
Greetings, doing well.
A little hard to hear.
Oh, could you speak up, Thomas? Thank you.
Is that better?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I would like to say, sounds like your book is great. I think I'm going to purchase it to get a little information because this is, wow. My question, first I'd like to say I think your father was certainly not ignorant. Did he charge black people for his legal services?
No, he tried to, but a lot of times they couldn't pay, and if they didn't pay, he worked for them anyway. So that's why he died without any money.
Why was he considered a slumlord?
He was considered a slumlord because he owned property in West Garfield Park, which is largely later known as Lawndale. And he had four properties. I don't think how many units it was, something like 35 or 40 units. And part of it was a mixing. In part, he was called a blockbuster and a slumlord because he rented to black people, period. And so there wasn't a distinction between people who rented to blacks just because a black person said, I'd like to rent your apartment, and people who rented to blacks in order to exploit them. And so he, by letting black people into his buildings fairly early on, was attacked by other whites as a slumlord and blockbuster. And he had to bring out, I have a letter from him where he said he had to have police in front of his building because white people kept breaking the windows, because he had black tenants. So there was that. And then as he, towards the end of his life, he died in 1965 when he was 49, he ran out of money. He put everything he had into maintaining his buildings, but he couldn't always maintain them. And as the rest of the neighborhood fell apart and he watched it falling apart, and it was falling apart because of this concentration of exploitative contract selling that was going on. So the neighborhood as a whole is falling down. He's trying to keep his property up. As one individual, he had a hard time doing it. And in the months that he was sick and dying, he didn't do much with the apartment and then his apartments. And then after his death, a lot of people who hated him said, he's a slumlord. He also got accused of being a slumlord because he had a code violation. It was a $25 code violation. And that was when he went on television to talk about contract sales. A guy named Len O'Connor was the TV host, and he's a white guy. And Len O'Connor, instead of listening to my father talk about the exploitation of black homebuyers, said, "Well, you're the problem. You're a slumlord. And he said, "You have this code violation." So he was often attacked in public in this way, and that had a lot to that was part of that, what we just said about, you know, white people who do stand against white supremacy get attacked pretty viciously by other white people, and that was part of the attack.
Okay, I think that's because they're not ignorant. When Gus asked you earlier if you were white, said you were a Jew, why? Because I look at your picture, you're obviously white. Do white people consider you white? If you go and another white person, if you say, hey, would they consider you a white person?
Yeah, I think I'm seen as white, but I identify as a Jewish person. So I think it's a significant part of my heritage and my religion. So, but I think I get all white privileges that any white person gets. People don't usually, from my name, they don't know that I'm Jewish necessarily. So I try to bring it out. And my father was very, his being Jewish mattered for the kind of work he did, because he, of course, was born in 1916. He lived through World War II and the Holocaust and all the horrors of that. And I think he felt that fighting racism was the least he can do if he's going to be someone who understands the viciousness and violence of any kind of bigotry and hatred. So that's why I bring it up. It's also part of the story of the book. In the book, I talk about Catholics, Jews, Protestants, people with religious backgrounds, give them a language in which to talk about what they see as right and wrong in the world. And it doesn't matter, as far as I can tell, what religion you are. Every religion has resources to fight injustice. And every religion also could allow people to not fight injustice. So, but it's how our culture works. So I think it's significant.
Okay. My last question, very quickly. In Chicago now, I see that they're building an Obama library or museum, and they're taking a huge amount of land from that black people own, I guess, to do this. Do you think that this is a form of gentrification?
No, I don't know. I was asked that before, and I don't know that much about it. But, it might be one of these situations where Obama would be damned if he didn't, because if he didn't put his library, you know, on the South Side where there's access, you know, for black Chicagoans to use his library, he might be condemned. And then if he does, where does he put it? So, but honestly, because I don't know the local situation, I don't know what's going on, I don't even want to come down on it. I don't really know.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Appreciate that, Thomas in New York. The person that dialed in last four digits, 5972. Did you have a question for Dr. Satter? Oh, I'm echoing. Wow, hurt my ears. If you are listening to the program, if you could turn it down or turn it off, because we could just hear it, just creates a lot of distortion if you're like listening online. 5972, are you with us?
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello to the guests and everyone. I'd like to ask the guests, do you believe that white people really do enjoy mistreating black people? And if there were no black people in this country or anywhere where Caucasians reside, do you think that they would, you know, start fighting one another, or they would go out and purposely try to find other people? I know this sounds kind of silly, but to me, that's what it seems like, how white people are seeing, like they live and breathe, you know, for a reason, you know, to hate on black people and other people of color, you know. And
so, yes, do I think if there weren't blacks, they would find somebody else, basically?
Yeah, like they have to have
most cultures, many, you know, in Japan, in India, in some African nations, there's a group that's set aside in Europe, all of Europe. It was historically the Jews. Before, in Japan, it was a different group. There's often I think it's something that many cultures have, and this culture has this disease. Other cultures, I think creating an out-group is pretty common, unfortunately. And You know, yeah, I think if they didn't have a visual marker of race to make a division and then exploit for profit, there would probably be another marker. It could be religion. It could be national origin. It could be occupational status. It could be any number of things. But I think that tendency to want to set off some people and then make use of their lack of power to benefit oneself and to make oneself feel superior, I think it's pretty deeply ingrained. But some white people are from places where they were underdogs in the other place, you know. Or then there's, you know, Asians and Latinos, and there's all kinds of people in the world.
So, no, but that's not normal, though. I mean, because in the animal kingdom, that's not normal. And we humans tend to take our ways of acting from the animals. I mean, animals only kill and harass when they are hungry and they need to eat. But it seems like that's a stronger way of acting with Caucasians. And also, it can be also actually said that you are not actually a Jew, because Jews, original Jews, are Africans. I mean,
all original people are African. Everyone is really originally African, and it's up to people. You know, some people want to deny this long history back to Africa. But you know, Jews are out of the Middle East. The Middle East is part of Africa. It's, you know, all that's where the first people were found. So that is just part of the human race. But I don't know if Caucasians are more bloodthirsty than other people. You know, there's examples of massacres and mutilations and horrors in many countries. I mean, I'm concerned with my country, so I look at how it works here. But I don't think it's a racial characteristic, because there are just too many massacres in too many parts of the world by too many different kinds of people. So how humans relate to the animal kingdom, you know, I don't know. I mean, but I think whatever the problem of humanity is, it's an opportunistic thing. If you have the chance to oppress others, many people do, and white people have had that chance in this country, and so they do. But that's my opinion on it. If you want to know.
But we are the greatest threat to your genetic annihilation. I mean, you know, since we are the darkest of the people, we, you know, that would make sense that you guys would hate us the most. I mean,
I don't think there's a logic to disliking darker skinned people. Or, you know, I mean, who cares? I think it'd be however people, there's a variety of the way people look. And I don't know. I mean, I guess I don't feel I'm biologically driven in that way. But that's, you know, that's an approach. I think when there are the thing is, white people, if you look at Europe and the wars in Europe, they've been horrible wars there, and they've had nothing to do with color, you know, and it goes back many, many centuries. And it's the same in pretty much any nation you look at. The further back you go, the more you find of wars of annihilation, torture, slavery, massacres, everything else. So, again, given that this happens within races, it happens across races, it's hard for me to think that it's specific to people trying to protect a genotype.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, on. Person that dialed in, 5234. Did you have a question for Dr. Satter?
Yes, I do. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. All right, good evening, Dr. Satter. Good evening, guests and the listeners. I just wanted to ask, Dr. Satter, do you think that your inability to agree with Gus's definition of racism, white supremacy, that inability to agree with him is an act of white supremacy itself? The reason why is because just about everything that Gus read from your book and the entire premise of this discussion is basically describing a system of white supremacy. And as far as what you just recently said, the only known people that have destroyed every group of people they have ever come into contact with are Caucasian people. And that is just a historical reality. So as a historian, I think when in your book, you're describing a complete system where people on all levels of society are definitely informed on how to treat black people. So the lowest of the low on the white totem pole will be more overt and maybe physically brutal, but the rest of them are literally practicing a sophisticated system of the complete destruction of black communities, and that is exactly in line with what he gave as a definition. So I just wanted to ask, do you think that your inability to agree with him when your book is describing that system, in the most minute, intimate detail, and you're unable to agree with that, even though in this discussion you've also been describing the system just for some of the things that you have conveyed in your discussion this evening?
I have to think about that. Basically, you ask me, do I think that my attitude is white supremacist? I think I have a slightly different definition of white supremacy. I actually think obviously most of what Gus is saying is straight out of my book. So I do detail how the system works. I think it's a smaller disagreement than he thinks or than you think, because I try to put the system together as a whole, but I think each person is playing their little part and doesn't necessarily know how the rest of it works. So, and I also, what my difference in emphasis is that I think the way white supremacy works is that white people like to think of themselves as superior, and they don't like to understand what they're doing explicitly. It's buried, it's hidden in their psyche. If it wasn't, they couldn't enjoy themselves as much. That's what I think. Is that in itself white supremacist? I don't know. I mean, I guess I'll let you judge that. But, there's an argument to be made either way, and I think it's fine to make the argument that they perfectly well understand. But I've talked to a lot of white people, and let me tell you, it seems to me they seem quite ignorant of the most basic workings of the society in which they live. Maybe they're hiding from me, maybe not, I don't know. But their default is always, there's just something wrong with the people, not, we created a whole system and isn't it great? But again, maybe they're not telling me the truth, I don't know.
Well, I was going to say, because I know that you said earlier that the white people that have read your book tell you that they become very informed about the way the system works, and that they themselves are not aware of it. And what I believe they're speaking to, correct me if I'm wrong, is how it works in real estate and the theft of black land. But the average white citizen knows how it works in other ways, just like Joe Zimmerman knew it was okay to murder an unarmed black male. He's the average, uneducated, he was a person of color supposedly, but his attitude was a white supremacist attitude, and he's the average person. So the bottom line is the average white person knows that they can treat this in any way that they want, and either they'll get away with it or they'll do very little time for it. Whereas the sophisticated ones who operate, let's say, the real estate system, they have a system in which everybody on every level has an understanding of how to treat us. So to me, when you have a society where even a homeless white person can mistreat a black person and get away with it, so they all have an understanding. It might be just different levels and different aspects of the way the game is played. So every white person knows mistreat a black person in any way, shape, or form, and more than likely you'll get away with it. And to me, that's a system. And that's been a system since this country began.
Yeah.
So I'll meet my line.
Right. I think that's correct.
The person that called in, Mr. Demery Four, your line should be open. Did you have a question for Dr. Satter, Mr. Demery Four? Oh, make sure I got his line. Mr. Demery Four, are you with us? Still not, I don't know if he hit his mute button or not. I'll double check again, make sure. All right, let's try again. Mr. Demery Four, can you hear us, sir?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Greetings, Gus. Greetings to Dr. Satter. Interesting book. I had a comment and a question, and could look at it as a two-part question, but I tuned in about 20, 25 minutes late. I don't know if she mentioned the fact that, when these practices were done, the contract, the redlining, the overcharging for real estate and the subsequent, you know, eviction and taking the property back had an effect on generations after that, because Americans were using real estate as a form of wealth building, and it could be passed along to members of your family and your grandkids. So it would be a form of accumulating wealth, and it affected black people in that way. And my question is, do you think that with this new deal that's going around, we buy homes and they basically offer a contract to the people that are distressed and then hold them to that contract and basically is gaining control of their property or their real estate? Do you think that that could be a form of racism and discrimination nowadays?
I'm not sure of that exact procedure, but I think your point, you expressed it very eloquently about how the ownership of property is a form of wealth creation that could, if it worked fairly, help people across generations. And when it works unfairly, it hurts people across generations. So I think that the whole recent subprime crisis has been another example of disproportionately tying African Americans into high interest predatory loans that again led to is leading as we speak to a generational wipeout of wealth yet again. So I'm not sure if that's exactly the kind of context you were talking about, but I think it's an ongoing process, and I think what happened in 2008 was sort of a nationwide replay of what had happened in black communities in the 50s and 60s. This time, you know, more people included whites as well as blacks, but still disproportionately black people, using housing, inverting it. Instead of using housing to build wealth, housing was peddled as a way of expropriating wealth, and it's a very tragic thing.
Thank you for taking my question. I'll leave my line, Gus.
Oh, for sure. Good to hear from you, Mr. Demery. For the person who dialed in, I guess you're using the free flash phone. Did you have a question for Dr. Satter? Your line should be open.
Greetings. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to say is that your book definitely sounds like it has some great information in it. It's an interesting history, but I wouldn't advise any black person to buy it. I just wanted to put that out there. Like, you can try to get it from the library or somewhere. But you said earlier, too, that I don't know if you used the term slumlord, but you said that they knew that they can make a killing. Were you being literal?
You know, sometimes, you know, because it could lead to death. Slums could lead to death when you have decaying banisters and somebody falls off the banister, when you have rats and someone gets bitten and gets sick and dies, if somebody freezes to death or, you know, gets sick because the heat isn't adequate. That question of indifference. You know, they couldn't care less. I talk about this in my book, at the very end of the line, after these properties were milked and milked and milked, that is, they took the payments from people but did no maintenance. That is, here I'm not talking about contract buyers. I'm talking about absentees from landlord owners. At the end of the line, they would sometimes insure the buildings and then set them on fire and get the insurance money. And I have cases of that in the book. So that is a case. You know, I think it's important to know that it is a metaphor. Make a killing means make a lot of money, but I think it could also be used literally in that this can be a life and death situation. The fires that we talked about earlier were a matter of people dying. So I think it goes both ways. I think it's an interesting metaphor. I didn't use it intentionally, but now that you mention it, I think you're right.
Yeah, thanks for your answer. I was just wondering. Well, yeah, thanks for your answer.
You're welcome.
I have a question. You were saying that it could be argued both ways, that, you know, white people know, you know, what they're, you know, about racism. They know that, you know, they know what they're doing. They know that they have power over them. And you were saying that, it's possible that they don't know.
Learned something from one of your from one of the speakers. I think one of the people who called put it really well. But they know they can get away with pretty much anything. They don't always know the complicated mechanism by which wealth is appropriated. I think that was quite accurate.
Maybe whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah.
My question is. If I told you that most white people that claim to be anti-racist and whatnot, they usually lean towards the side of don't know, like they give white people like a lot of benefit of the doubt. And my question is, like, how would you explain that?
How would I explain them leaning that way? Some of it is, again, real belief. Like I said, I wasn't personally knowledgeable about the intricacies of how economic exploitation worked. I had to learn it. So I have that sense of it. There's also, I think it could be a desire to not want to turn off the people you want to change. You know, so I think that could be part of it. You're more open to more subtle in your discussion. It could be that. For me, it was, again, that I didn't understand the complex financial mechanisms, but I actually did understand that, and I do agree about the sense that, you know, you can get away with anything, not knowing why people are in the situation they're in necessarily, but knowing that here are these people, we can do whatever we want. So I don't know if that answers your question. I can't really speak for other people. I can only really speak for myself.
Yeah, it just seems like a pattern, and I was just wanting to get your perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And your answer was interesting, and like you don't want to offend the people that you're trying to change. And it just sounds like you would rather. I mean, if you're gonna make an error, it would seem like you would try to make the error on the side of not the white people that you don't want to offend, but the black people that you don't want to have false information. You know, incorporate these lies into their lives, and I just,
that's a really good point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You're talking about people you're trying to change. You know, like okay, you're a white person. You know what I'm saying? And you know, as far as changing yourself, I mean, I don't know. Like, start there. Like, are you going to change now, or are you going to change your behavior? I mean, a lot of things that you said, just, you know, logically, sometimes it don't add up, and it's because you're giving, you know, these white people, you know, you have this, you know, giving white people, you know, the benefit of the doubt, and, for whatever reason. You said why, but just wondering, will you change your behavior and how you present the fact that you know you said it could be argued both ways, so I don't know, just wondering how are you going to change.
Well, I'll tell you, what I'm doing right now is I'm working on another book, and it's about, broadly speaking, it's about racism and capitalism. More narrowly, it's about this bank, which I mentioned earlier, Shore Bank, South Shore Bank, which had a racially mixed ownership. But which was an attempt to funnel capital into South Shore, which is a predominantly black neighborhood in Chicago. And so far, you know, the way I'm changing, I think what I'm trying to do is continue to push myself to understand as deeply as I can how these systems work economically, technically, in all those ways, so that I can continue to explain it in as clear a way as I can to as many people as I can. So that, you know, it's funny, you know, because I actually, I teach women's history, and I often get women's students, and they say, I teach U.S. women's history, among other things, and they say, can men be feminists, and should men take this class, and stuff like that? And I say, you know, I think they should, because I think even, you know, no matter how many times you hold on to your older arrogance, or you stumble, or you say something stupid, or you manifest how you were raised as opposed to what you need to know, it's still worth the shot. You know, it's still worth trying to learn. And so I'm continuing to try to learn whatever mistakes I might make along the way. So I guess that's your answer.
Man, wow. Oh, God. Let me ask you this. Do you know of any white people that exclusively deals with racism, white supremacy, and, you know, like, don't get into feminism and capitalism, you know, like, they just dedicate their study and writings to white supremacy? I was just curious. Do you know any white people like that?
Maybe.
That's my last question.
I'm a historian, so I know historians, and I'm trying to think of, most people think of these things as somewhat interconnected, and they, you know, feeding off each other in one way or another. And so, I don't know, there's a book called The Progressive Investment in Whiteness by a guy named George Lipsitz, L-I-P-S-I-T-Z, and that whole book is about how white supremacy operates. I think it's very good. I know there are more. There's a guy named David. I mean, there are a lot of white people who write about, well, there was a whole school of writing about sort of how whiteness operates. And one of the first books on that was a book by a guy named David Rodiger called The Wages of Whiteness. And it was, again, about sort of the financial benefits. So I think if you looked at The Progressive Investment in Whiteness, this book by George Lipsitz, if you had some kind of library catalog and you looked under the subject headings of that, you might find other books that do the same thing, that try to get at this.
Winding down. Let's see, the caller at 7537. Did you have a question for Dr. Satter?
Yes, I do. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you may hear some background noise because I'm on the bus, but earlier in the program, with the first caller, the guest talked about she enjoys white privilege, and then you brought up that your father grew up during the time of World War II with Nazi Germany. I was wondering, would you classify the Nazis as enjoying white privilege?
They were more specific, you know, because they thought Poles were an inferior race, and gypsies, and homosexuals, and Jews, and all kinds of people. So they didn't have an inclusive vision of whiteness. They had a more exclusive vision that really just included themselves. But the idea of wanting to exterminate your inferiors actually has a long history, and it goes back to the late 19th century at the very least. And the idea of wanting to wipe out your inferiors and believing that you're evolutionary, that you have an evolutionary superiority and things like that was actually a widespread idea on both sides of the Atlantic until about the 1920s, and when it got challenged. So the Nazis kind of held to what had been a dominant idea across Europe, and the United States for that matter, held on to it longer and enacted it more brutally than others. But in some ways, they were just an expression of a larger set of beliefs about racial superiority, that certain races were better than others, and that those races should exterminate what they called inferior races. And that was all over 1800s America in terms of the extermination of Native people. So that was mostly how it was used in the United States against Native Americans, American Indians, and in other parts of the world it was used against other people whose land was coveted.
Okay, but so if you see that it's different during the Nazi term, well, the reason I brought it up is because during the World War II, we saw that the Nazis were also exterminating African people on the continent. And they were doing a lot of the same things as white people have done across the planet. So I'm just curious as to why you say that, and you still do it today, so I'm curious as to why you say that you enjoy white privilege now, but back then, that's not white privilege. Because to me, white privilege doesn't really accurately describe what's really going on.
Let's see. Well, I was born in 1959, so I'm not entirely sure what about back then. But you know, Jews in Europe were hunted down and exterminated, and were seen as non-whites in that period. And in the United States, it was
so. Would you say that they did? So you're saying that the Jews back then didn't enjoy white privilege?
Not in Nazi-dominated Europe, they didn't. But after World War II is really when most of the really overt, explicit anti-Semitism in the United States went out of fashion to some extent. They began to allow Jews into colleges and law schools and things like that. They stopped doing Christian-only want ads and things like that. So, and some of it was a reaction to what the Nazis had done in the United States, a reaction against that kind of excess, which you know, made clear where an idea of supremacy can lead. But the truth is we haven't gotten rid of an idea of racial supremacy, and it could always go there again. We hope it won't.
Okay, I have a final question. What are some of the specific things that you do to enjoy white privilege?
What do I do to enjoy white privilege? I mean, I think I have white privilege just because police usually don't harass me.
I'm asking what specific things that you do to enjoy white privilege. In order for you to get the white privilege, what do you do? It's like, is it a privilege to get a driver's license? You have to do something in order to get it. So what do you do to enjoy the privilege?
What actions do I take? It's so pervasive. I don't really, I have to say, did you ever see that brilliant Eddie Murphy sketch about white privilege where he puts on white face? It's from the 70s, from Saturday Night Live. And he dresses up as a white person, puts on white face, and in one part, he goes into a bank, and he there's a black loan officer, and the officer, he says he wants a loan. The loan officer says, we need your collateral. We need to know all this background information. And then a white officer comes in, loan officer comes in, and sends the black guy away and says to the white Eddie Murphy, how much do you need? We'll just give it to you, and Eddie Murphy's in shock as he's seeing what it's like on the other side. And, it's a caricature, that Eddie Murphy sketch. There's a truth to it, that there's just sort of an ease in interaction or a better treatment. Things work the way they're supposed to work on this side of things. And white people often think they just deserve that rather than that it's set up that way. So I'm trying to think how you would reject it. It would be, I guess the main thing we'd have to do is when you see it, not working for non-white people, you have to fight that. But that I think that's how it works. It's a whole, when people talk about police brutality, I don't really fear police brutality. I'm highly unlikely to be harassed. Whereas if I were a black woman, my likelihood would be quite high. So it just goes on like that. Whether it's in a bank getting better treatment, whether it's in real estate looking for a house, whether it's the police, whether it's in schools, we have studies, unfortunately, that black girls in particular actually get pretty harsh treatment for minor behavioral infractions that white little girls don't get. So it's a broad, broad thing.
The person that dialed in last four digits, 1447, 1447, did you have a question for Dr. Satter?
Yes, sir. Hey, Gus. Appreciate the show. Appreciate the guests for coming. My question is, do you think that white people have collectively more power than non-white people?
In this country? Yeah, probably. I think they do. Yeah, I think they do. In part because of a century or more, two centuries, three centuries, of expropriation of wealth. So you put all that together, and there's a huge financial divide. And the divide, interestingly, it's not in income as much anymore. It's in wealth. So income is what you earn from your job. That has evened out a little bit or more so, but the wealth inequalities are huge, and that is the kind of generational wealth, that the kind of housing discrimination that I was talking about and that other people on Gus's show have discussed, that leads to those gross inequalities in wealth. And wealth is, you know, the extra money you have that could pay for your kids' college education, that could you know, give you a little step up, that could do the down payment for the next generation's home. And that's one of the places of inequality is most obvious, and where it's quite clear that whites on the whole have greater power than blacks.
You know, I hear you saying wealth, but you know, I not consider the wealth be equated with power. But do you have any desire to try and end the system of racism, white supremacy?
I would like to see it ended, because I think it is grotesque. I think it hurts everyone to live in a society that's unjust and unequal. I think all people have an interest in healthy, safe communities, not just a healthy, safe community up to the line, and then you cross that line, and then it's the reverse, you know. I think there's a lot of greed, and a lot of people don't want to share, and can never get enough. A lot of white people, this probably holds for some black millionaires, but I don't know. But I think the level of sense that you can never have too much, whether it's wealth or power, is wrong. And I would like to see a society where good health and good education and safety and culture and love is more broadly shared. And I think you have to tackle it wherever it is that you find yourself, whether it's if you work in a particular place at your workplace, or as you raise your kids, or however it might be. But that's how I feel about it. I think it's poison. It's a poison in society, and especially, you know, we have economic decline in this country, and in some ways, the desire to cordon off of the wealthiest, most powerful people, to cordon themselves off and live in gated communities and hire guards, that's no way to live. It's a horrifying way to live, and they would rather do that than share the wealth. And I think my personal opinion is that sharing the wealth would be a much saner and safer way to live.
Okay. If we are in agreement that white people have more power than black people or non-white people, do you think the system of racism, white supremacy, could end without the help of the most powerful people, white people?
A hard question. Because it's predicting the future, and say I'm a historian and I focus on the past, so it's way easier to know. But I think it would help a hell of a lot to have white people on board in some way. I don't know if it could happen without their cooperation, because they remain a majority, but they're not going to be a majority for long. Everyone is predicting that the white majority situation in this country is going to end in maybe even 20 years. And then, you know, so maybe they won't be needed at that point. And that would be fine. That would be, you know, they had their chance, they didn't take it. So, you know, we're just going to have to see demographically, you know, what happens in this country.
Okay. Well, thank you, Gus. But I do think that regardless of whether they're a majority or not, if they have the power, they can be the minority and still control. But I appreciate your response, and thanks, Gus, for having me on. I'll mute my line.
Good hearing from you and all of the callers. We actually had a caller write in, a Chicago resident. He said that he was just talking to another Chicago citizen, and he's a black person, and he said that he didn't know a lot about the history of Cicero. And so he wrote in, and he wanted to know if you mentioned that, and I gave a good chuckle, and I said I will read a few of the points that I highlighted, and then if there's anything you want to fill in, you can do so. But so he asked about Cicero. This is from your book on page 202. Where you wrote, the last time a black family had attempted to move to Cicero, a white mob smashed windows and ripped down the trees around their apartment complex. The riots stopped only when police flooded the area. That was in 1951. By 1966, little had changed. In May of that year, a black teenage honor student named Jerome Huey had gone into the neighborhood to apply for a job. He was attacked by four white teenagers who smashed his head so severely that his eyes were beaten out of his skull. The boy died. Cicero. You don't know what Cicero meant to people in Chicago, said Clory Bryant, a black Chicagoan. You didn't walk through Cicero alone. You didn't let your car break down in Cicero. You just didn't go to Cicero if you were black. Moving forward in the text a tad, so you have all these marches and what have you. Dr. King comes, moving forward in the 60s. On September 4th, 1966, Labor Day weekend, the Cicero March finally took place. Mayor Daley dispatched 2,000 National Guardsmen and 1,000 police to protect 250 marchers from a mob of 3,000 whites. Cicero's whites shouted, "Go back to Africa," and 2, 4, 6, 8, "We don't want to integrate." The marchers called back, "Black power. Black power." They stopped at the site where Jerome Huey had been murdered. Huey's parents, Isaac and Ruth, were present. Mrs. Huey wept as one of the marchers, a theology student, said a prayer in her son's memory. While the group prayed, hundreds of whites crowded around them, waving swastikas and shouting taunts. Moving forward again, the white press reaction to the Cicero March was considerably murkier. The Chicago Sun-Times called it an irresponsible and pointless act, talking about the marchers, while acknowledging that the hoodlums who tried to break it up are irresponsible lawbreakers who deserve rough treatment from the police and National Guardsmen. The paper insisted, nevertheless, that there should have been no march in the first place. National press reaction was even more skewed. Papers across the country printed headlines like "Guards Bayonet Hecklers in Cicero's Rights March." They published photos of heavily armed guardsmen menacing white teenagers, reinforcing the idea that the violent white mob had been the victim and not the oppressor. Anything you want to add in about, I guess, the Oak Park area, Berwyn, and or Cicero?
Well, that sums up Cicero. It was just absolutely notorious for hate and hate crimes. One thing I might just add, that Martin Luther King, when he marched there, when he marched in Chicago, actually, he was stoned by whites, and he said that whites in Mississippi should come to Chicago to learn how to hate. So he was shocked by what he saw there. I'm not sure what's happening in Cicero today, but it had this reputation. And it's also, by the way, extremely having a reputation for a great deal of corruption and mob activity, white mob activity, organized crime.
Hope, as I said, if you live in Chicago, you should get this book. I'm sure there are many, many other. Chicago is kind of an infamous spot for segregation and studying racism and what have you. But I think this one gives lots of juicy tidbits. Two final ones I want to make sure that I get. And I said I was passing to myself earlier, Ta-Nehisi Coates, that quote that I read about greatly pained white people, which, again, I assert is highly incorrect. That piece, he was writing about the New Republic's history of racism. He was basically saying in them not having very many black staff members, and even the times when they did address and talk about racism, that most of the time it was something in support of the bell curve, which basically says black people are not very intelligent, and other kind of the same trite notions about how we think about black people and why they are in the predicament that we're in, not racism. Interestingly enough, New Republic pops up in your text where you're talking about your brother David, when he writes this letter where he basically says that Dr. King, he might be a little off in his assessment of this slum situation. This is from your book on page 217 for me, where you write, within weeks of your brother David's essay, he received a flood of congratulatory letters. Typical was one from George W. Beadle, a Nobel Prize-winning scientist who was then the president of the University of Chicago. Beadle praised David for examining the slum problem objectively and without oversimplification. He added that he'd recently learned of a new city program to teach public aid recipients something about housekeeping. It is a long job, and as you say, many changes are necessary. Housing administrators far and wide enthused over the article. The Housing Affairs Letter, a Washington, D.C. newsletter, praised David's piece as the best report we've seen in a long time. Peter G. Burns, the director of the City of Ottawa's Housing Code Program, wrote that he agreed with almost every point and theory advanced by Mr. Satter in his article. This was just the beginning. In July 1966, David published a slightly revised version of his essay, now titled West Side Story, Home is Where the Welfare Check Comes, in the New Republic. Once again, David warned against taking the easy way out of attacking the exploiters and doing little else, as Martin Luther King Jr. was doing. I will stop there. You acknowledge that your brother got way more fame and attention, and even got his essays published in magazines and journals that your father could not, to explain the slum situation at the ripe and mature age of 18. He is a recognized scholar on this. Can you talk about this and what that reveals about racism?
Yeah, it's pretty shocking. First of all, my father tried to get an article published in the New Republic, and his article was about, it was attacking welfare as it was currently constructed because it forced families apart, because money would only go to a dependent woman if her husband was gone, and it forced men to leave so that their wives could survive, and he thought that was deeply unjust. But what he thought should be done in its place was a kind of a something like what they had in the 1930s, the WPA, the Works Progress Administration, where there were government jobs for everyone who wanted to work. And he used to said we needed a massive program of that sort to help people, because he said most people actually want to work. That was never published. He tried over and over, the New Republic wouldn't publish it. And then my brother, who was very young, a teenager, a college student, wrote an article in which he said that the cause of the decay in black neighborhoods was welfare recipients, that welfare recipients were so beaten down and degraded by the fact that they didn't have to work and that they didn't care and all this sort of stuff, that they were the problem in these communities, and that was the problem that needed to be faced. That was his argument. And that got all this attention. That got published, as you read. Everyone wrote in to say how wonderful. There was even a famous columnist named Joseph Alsop. He wrote for the Washington Post. And he wrote in, to my brother and said, Mr. Satter, you must have been studying this topic for a long time. You know, I wonder how long you've been studying it. He was 18, my brother. But, you know, was studying it since he was 8. You know, I mean, it was absurd, the sort of overreaction to him writing. It was a well-written piece, but it was an uninformed piece. And it was the piece by a kid who was echoing what his teachers at the University of Chicago were telling him. But that's what they wanted to hear. So I think it shows how eager the mainstream press is, and many wealthy white people, to find to hear a story about poor black neighborhoods that blames poor black people for the problems of those neighborhoods. And whereas if even a white person writes something more detailed that implicates white people in the impoverishment of these neighborhoods, that is not welcome. That is much harder. That was certainly in 1965, 66, in the New Republic, much harder to get out into, you know, into press. it's a horrible irony. It's a tough thing for me to find out and to write about. I was 7 years old when all this happened, so I had to find out about it after the fact.
Wow. I would contrast that with everything you just laid out, anything that is talking about how lazy and shiftless and irresponsible black people are. Hey, get that out right now, immediately, front page.
Right. Doesn't matter if you're 18. Doesn't matter how old you are. Doesn't matter, nothing really matters. What matters is the message.
Exactly. And in contrast, I think this is a great point because I was reading this. I didn't know anything about this either. You really stress, and Ta-Nehisi Coates, many other people, the importance, the FHA, that, yes, this is really bad, but this is like government-sanctioned economic terrorism because the Federal Housing Administration is not insuring loans for black people. Doesn't matter what your credit score is. Doesn't matter how much money you have. They're not doing that. So this is, just state-sanctioned, as I said, economic terrorism that leads to all of this. So you start to get some reforms. Eventually, the FHA says, okay, we will insure loans, even in riot-prone areas, code for black people. So this starts to happen. But again, and this, as I said, this is just more evidence, in my view, we're not talking about white stupidity. We're not talking about white people lacking information. We're talking about collective white pathology. And again, white people have made fleecing black people one of the most profitable enterprises on the planet. So the FHA, they make their change, and then you write on 352, the results, now we get the new scam, the results of this scam could be seen in the bombed out appearance of many central cities where block after block of structurally sound housing had been abandoned. New York Times reporter John Herbers noted in 1972, of course, while the scandal meant ruin for some, it meant huge profits for others. In Chicago, the FHA paid out at least $42 million to real estate speculators and corrupt mortgage firms. In Brooklyn, such operators received $250 million from the FHA. In Detroit, which was hardest hit by the scandal, FHA insurance payments amounted to a shocking $375 million. $375 million to $500 million, as Brian Boyer observed. In return for this immense payout to Detroit's mortgage brokers and speculators, the U.S. government received a deserted slum and the concomitant concomitant problems of rampant heroin addiction and the highest big city murder rate in the USA. Later generations had a simpler and distorted explanation for the desolation they saw in Detroit and other black urban areas. The devastation was caused, they insisted, by the riots. Just can you detail the conclusion here, the new scam when the FHA did decide to insure these loans?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. So what happened was that basically, the pattern in U.S. history in terms of black access to credit is they either are granted no access or they're granted predatory access. It's either no loans or predatory loans, no loans or predatory loans. And so in this case, the FHA, up until 1968, gave no loans and left black people victims to contract selling, which was a form of predatory lending. Then they changed their policy and decided, as you quoted, that they would insure 100% loans that were made in riot-prone areas, by which they meant black neighborhoods or urban neighborhoods that were adjacent to black neighborhoods. And the way the scam worked was, well, the way it was supposed to work was that a person who needed a home could buy, that there would be an FHA appraisal first, because usually you don't insure something unless you've appraised it. And once an FHA appraisal decided that the house was in good shape, someone could buy that home for about $200 down, which was more than it is now, but it was still not much. And then they could pay off the rest and over 30 years, and they get this nice house. And a bank would be happy to make the loan to the person, even though they have a low down payment, because the loan is insured. All right, that's how it's supposed to work. But that is not how it did work. The way it did work was that people understood, real estate speculators immediately got the idea that if something is insured 100%, all you have to do is sell it and you get your payback, and it doesn't matter that what you're being pushed to do actually is make a loan at the highest possible interest rate and with the highest possible service fees, so that someone will default and then you'll get that 100% payment back plus your service fees, so you benefit. So what they did was, what speculators did was they went through black neighborhoods and what they called changing neighborhoods, neighborhoods in which black people were just starting to move. And they would find an appraiser, FHA appraiser, and they would pay them off to grossly inflate the value of the house. So say there's a house worth, I know this is a little complicated, but it's worth hanging on and listening, I think. Say a house is worth $5,000. A speculator could get a corrupt FHA appraiser to say the house is worth $20,000, not like four times as much as it is actually worth. Then they find some person who doesn't have much money, who desperately wants a home, and they say, look, you know, we'll help you with the paperwork. It's only $200 down. Don't worry about what it costs in the end. We'll take care of everything, and we'll fill out your loan application, and we'll say that you can carry the loan and leave it all up to us. And then someone ends up, you know, putting $200 down and moving into a house that is a $5,000 house that they have committed to pay $20,000 for. And normally a bank would not loan someone a mortgage that is so inflated. But because the mortgages were 100% guaranteed, the banks would loan the money because they knew it didn't matter if the buyer defaulted or not, they get paid back. So what they want to do is make the loan at the highest possible cost and at the greatest possible rate of interest, have the person pay for a while, and then if they can't make it, so what? They get the money back from the government. That's how the government gets defrauded, and the person's out of the house, and you can sell the same house over and over. So this is actually very close to the subprime mortgage crisis, because in the 2008 situation, it was very similar. People, real estate brokers, were doing their best to make the highest possible cost and the highest possible interest rate loans to people, whether or not they could pay it back, because they knew they would sell that loan immediately to Wall Street. So they had no concern about the creditworthiness of who was buying. In fact, their goal was to get people to overextend themselves to the greatest possible extent. So what happened in the 70s was textbook. It was almost exactly the same, except instead of selling the loan to Wall Street, they would insure the loan with the federal government. In either case, it didn't matter whether the person could pay. So people would move into these houses that didn't have plumbing, that were in horrible condition, that would never pass a legitimate appraisal, find that they couldn't keep up these inflated payments, and give it up after they've already, of course, given up their down payment and paid all kinds of service fees and such. And then the people who sold them the house at the inflated price would say, that's fine, goodbye, I'm collecting that entire sale price that you were supposed to pay me, I'll just collect it from the FHA insurance. And this happened in Mass, and it happened in cities across the country. It was a badly constructed program, so it was easy to manipulate, and it was manipulated, and it resulted in many abandoned homes. And the point about Detroit, I mentioned that people always say that the problems in Detroit were because of the 67 riots, but as I say in the book, I think the approximation is 2,500 homes damaged in the riots of 1967, but the number of homes that were damaged or abandoned because of the manipulation of this new FHA policy in the 1970s was 25,000 homes. It's 10 times as many. So I think that manipulation of that policy is much more responsible for any problems of the city than the rebellion of 67 or the riots of 67 that people like to blame for the problems of the city and many other cities across the country. They say the same thing about Chicago, that all the problems are caused by, quote-unquote, the riots, not arson by landlords, not predatory real estate practices and things like that, which I think had a much, much more profound effect.
Monumentally important with all that talk, the bankruptcy and everything that's been going on in Detroit for about the past year or so. I don't think I have heard one person mention these FHA scams. I mean, $500 million in just Detroit. My God.
But think about that in terms of 1970s money.
Exactly.
I mean, I think you'd have to multiply by 8 or 10.
Exactly.
For today's money. So that is even more than it sounds.
I mean, that is astronomical. And again, I can only repeat, white people have made the fleecing and exploitation of black people one of the most profitable enterprises on the planet. That should be uncontested and just repeated ad nauseum until it sinks in. And people should think about that when they think, or anytime someone says that white people are ignorant about racism. But the final point I wanted to bring in, if you want to respond or what have you before your exit, in reading this, one of the things that was kind of challenging for me, I have a very difficult time as a victim of white supremacy in reading. And I mean, there's so many stories of just horrendous things happening to black, specific black families, individual black people, and then collectively what's happening to black people with all of this. I've noticed a pattern where we'll start off talking about black people being harmed or mistreated and how terrible white supremacy is. And somehow it shifts to white victims, almost what we heard in Cicero, where the white mob attacking black people or interracial marchers, this white mob, they become the victims of police brutality. It's been my experience that consistently this happens where somehow we end up focusing on a white victim. I mentioned Viola Louisa earlier, Reverend James Reeb in Selma, the two white boys who died with James Chaney down in Mississippi, Freedom Summer, that this happens consistently. That was one thing. It was challenging me to read a book that, where you focus a lot about your father and the difficulties and his death at 49 and leaving your mom. She's got all these young children and terrible thing. It's kind of that same thing of white people as victims popping up. That was a bit challenging for me. And I'll contrast it just to get your response, because I think you had said earlier, a system that pits everyone against each other. When I look at your family, and this is supposed to be, you know, a tragedy, what happened with you all, even when I watch how that all plays out, even with your mom in this terrible situation, and she's battling cancer and operations and having to deal with all this and not very much money and just a real struggle for your family, even with that, your brother goes on to become a Rhodes Scholar, goes to Oxford. You become a history, aren't you the chair of the history department? You're not just a professor, aren't you the chair of the history department at Rutgers?
Not anymore. Okay. I was for a little while. Now someone else is chair.
Okay.
But I've done well. I mean, I'm a tenured professor.
There we go. And I'm just like, Wow. Like, you put that in contrast to some of these black fans. I don't know Clyde Ross, but I suspect Clyde Ross's grandchildren are not cheering the Department of History or Economics at some major university. I suspect his grandchildren are not Rhodes Scholars and what have you. It's just immense. Even the white people that are not rich, even the poor white people, just astronomically better chances for your quality of life. Even if you're poor, down and out, and you don't have all the nickels of some of these more powerful white people. That just, it was amazing seeing what happened to your father's children. And these are supposed to be poor white people. That was one. If you want to respond to that.
Well, I think your observation is valid. You know, two of us did pretty well. Most of us, we did fine. We still had white privilege in that sense. We didn't have wealth. That's why I think, you know, the amount of greed, what people think they need versus what they actually need is, it's a distortion. You don't need to have this kind of familial wealth to find a way to write and do well. It also helps if you don't challenge the system, but sometimes it works if you do. What can I say? I think you're right. I mean, I'm going to write about my family with empathy because it's my family. And, you know, my father, I wrote the book in part to find out about him because I was so young when he died. And I did want to know about him, and it was important for me to learn it. It was the first half of the book was about him, and then I shift to other people. But I think I think your point is legitimate, that no matter what, some of us still do fine. And you're right. I don't think Clyde Ross's family did as well. I mean, Clyde Ross had everything going for him in terms of being a smart, talented, hardworking person. But if you read Ta-Nehisi Coates' article, he details how from a very early age, first in the South and then later in Chicago, there were very systematic obstacles put in his path. Nevertheless, he became a spokesperson, he became an activist, but the acquisition of wealth was barred to him, largely, and I think the point makes sense.
Right on. We had one straggler. Do you have time to take a final caller before we let you go?
Sure.
And you, Baltimore, wasn't Baltimore one of those areas where they had a lot of those FHA scams in the 70s once they did start giving out loans? Wasn't some of that in Baltimore too?
Yes, Baltimore was also a big center for contract selling before mm-hmm. the FHA scam. So Baltimore was very similar to Chicago. They were two of the worst places for installment contract scams and then later FHA HUD scandal problems.
Freddie Gray. Wow.
There's a legacy. There's a legacy.
Absolutely. I think our caller might be close to the Baltimore area. Bruce Fine, did you have a final question for Dr. Satter?
Yes. Good evening, Gus, and good evening to your guests. To the guests, Gus often asks the question, what does it mean to be white? And I have a quick statement and a question for you. Earlier, you seem to, you know, hem and haw a little bit about your status being classified as white. You said that you are Jewish. Mm-hmm. When your people were in Germany, Hitler basically said that you guys were worthy of the Holocaust because you were not Aryan, i.e. white. We can fast forward to Israel today, and there are tons and tons of stories and evidence of Jews, white Jews, practicing racism, white supremacy against their so-called Ethiopian fellow chosen people of God. Do you think that the Ethiopian Jews with this mistreatment that they are going through over in Israel because they are not white, do you think that they would conclude that being white, being classified as white, trumps being the so-called chosen people of God, of the Most High God?
Mm-hmm. I don't know, but I think that the sad truth is that Jews are no better or worse than anyone else, and being Jewish doesn't prevent them from being racist. Having been the victim of horrible crimes doesn't mean that when the tide turns and you're in power rather than out of power, that you won't commit crimes. And I think that's true of Jews, Catholics, Protestants, Hindus, Muslims, Buddhists, pretty much all people. And so,
But the Jews in Israel are practicing racism, white supremacy against the Ethiopians because they are not white. The ones who are practicing the racism have gotten, once you guys were taken out of Germany, you were given one of the greatest, or not one of the greatest, protection plans under the in this world. And as you were reclassified from not being Aryan, i.e., white, to being classified as white. And Gus asked the question, "What does it mean to be white?" And it means you practice racism, white supremacy. And so when you guys went from being not white to being classified as white, you understood that you must act like white people. You must act white. And that's why I asked the question. The Ethiopian Jews are supposed to be God's people too, but they are being mistreated because they are black. So would you think that they would conclude that, wow, I am supposed to be the Most High's people, but not being white trumps that? Mm-hmm. Based on how they're being mistreated, would you...
Yeah. I don't know, and I can't speak for them, but what I can say is, and I think it would be inappropriate for me to say what an Ethiopian Jew would think, but I do know that this idea of people becoming white and then practicing the same exclusions that were practiced against them is, again, not uncommon. And in the United States, in the early 20th century, Italians weren't seen as white. Irish, even in the 1850s, were seen as Celts and not white. A lot of the imagery against them was exactly the same as the imagery against blacks. They were depicted as subhuman and violent and drinkers and all of that. So a lot of the different European immigrant groups were not seen as white initially when they first came to this country, and whiteness was, is with the Nazis, was sort of reserved for Northern Europeans. And then over the course of the 20th century, they were sort of admitted to the club of whiteness and then turned around and practiced the same exclusion, and sometimes against fellow people of their same religion. So Protestants against Protestants. There's lots of sad examples of black Catholics being abused by white Catholics. So I think, you know, I guess part of what you're asking is, does whiteness trump religious solidarity? And I think it does. I think it does. I think historically we've seen that happen, and it looks like it's happening right now.
Okay, Gus, I don't have any further questions.
Glad you were able to get it in. The book again, and I do not frequently encourage black people to read white people's writings on racism because frequently they are not truthful in discussing white supremacy, racism, but this one does have a lot of accurate information. I think folks would benefit, as I said, if you read N.D.B. Connolly, A World More Concrete, Andrew Kahrl, The Land Was Ours, and then Family Properties, Race, Real Estate, and the Exploitation of Black Urban America, Beryl Satter. If you read those three together, I think you will get a quantum leap in your understanding of racism. And keep in mind about whether or not white people are ignorant. If you read those three books, I think you'll be able to come to a definitive conclusion for yourself on that matter. Thoroughly enjoyed having you on the program. Really enjoyed the text. Great dialogue. We will look forward to having you back to speak with us if you have the time, Dr. Satter.
Oh, thank you so much. I'd love to come back. So this was wonderful, and I really appreciate your invitation to speak.
For sure. Enjoy the rest of your evening, and we will be in touch.
Okay, thank you.
Take care, Dr. Satter.
Bye-bye.
Mm-hmm. Context of White Supremacy. Fascinating. We should have time if folks want to give any feedback, what they heard, you know, thought it was constructive, you got any useful information, particularly if there are any Chicago residents, any folks in Chicago, if you knew about some of this history, familiar with some of this, definitely be good to hear from you all as well. We will take a quick commercial break, and then once that's all done, we'll hit folks who dialed in who have a hand up. Context of White Supremacy. We will be right back.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
RacismDaily.com, your number one source for global news reports on race, racism, and overt actions of white supremacy. From Asia to the Americas to Europe to Australia to Africa, racism is not a thing of the past. It is our current reality. Be informed. Be globally informed. You should be the first to know. RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com.
Is racism hurting you? On issues of race, are you unable to speak, think, and act with clarity and confidence? Are you tired of laughing when nothing is funny, smiling when you are not happy, agreeing when you really disagree? counterracism.com, you can learn specific strategies and techniques to counter the behaviors of the people who practice racism in all areas of activity. Using words correctly, following counter-racist logic, even counter-racist science projects designed to reveal what racism is, how it works, and how to counter it. The open source code writing format allows you to pick and choose from a variety of counter-racist suggestions so you can produce the code that works for you. Stop by counterracism.com today and help replace racism with justice.
That's counter-racism.com.
Do you need a one-stop shop for all of your multimedia needs? Triumphant Multimedia is a skilled team of professionals with a passion for great marketing and chic design. Our specialties include consulting, brand development, copywriting, and creative graphic design. That's second to none. We also offer photography, photo retouching, videography, and video editing. At Triumphant Multimedia, our goal is to provide highly effective creative solutions built to suit any individual need or budget. Give us a call at 678-732-8067 or check us out online at TRIMultimedia.com.
Hi everyone, welcome. This is Justice with the Cows Radio program. If you want to learn about, understand, and counter racism, white supremacy, be sure not to miss a Cows episode. We keep them jammed, packed with constructive information to sharpen your use of words, to help eliminate the system of racism, white supremacy, ASAP. Also, to be able to invest in my counter-racist efforts, co-hosting the Cows Radio program, please visit my blog, justdojusticetoday.blogspot.com.
Here's a saying, just buckets and buckets of words.
Context of White Supremacy. We will be back on Thursday. Study session, Asada Shakur. I think we had number six. I think we are at number six, but I think we have two of these left. I think we have this week and next week we are done. So you should be thinking of new books. People have made a lot of different suggestions for the book that we would like to do next for the book club. You all will be voting on it. I guess I'll list all of the books and then people can submit their votes. I'll try and do it all in one place so I won't have to kill myself with the tabulations, but we'll try to put it all in one spot so that people can vote. And we'll do that. But that is down the road. In the immediate, Asada Shakur, study session number six, this Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Tune in. Again, fundraising, summer 2015. Invest if you think the program is constructive, racism-notes.blogspot.com. Listener-supported, counter-racist radio. PayPal button is in the top right corner. If you're not into PayPal, feel free to drop me an email and we will get you a mailing address. Big thanks to all the folks who have invested down through the years. I hope the program has been, continues to be worthy of your time and energy. You can also invest. We have our wish list up at Amazon.com under Gus T. Renegade. You'll see a few trinkets, hopefully constructive, things you can nab that would also be helpful. I know somebody, I got my RAM and hard drive. I had been hearing about that and saying things you can do if you want to upgrade your computer. Man, I doubled my RAM and got a solid state hard drive. My computer is faster than when I got it out of the box. I am no fan of white people, period, and certainly no fan of Apple, but the TechNews had said you will get a gargantuan speed boost and overall performance boost if you double your RAM and get a hard, solid state hard drive, and it was massive, but I did get that off my wish list, and my computer has never been better. Wow. Anywho, back to the text, just to kind of make sure I emphasize this book, just lots of constructive information, shared. I certainly don't think white people are ignorant. And I was not really interested in hearing, you know, all this about her family. I know she talked about she was, of course, going to be empathetic, talking about her dad and mom and brothers and all of that, of course. But I mean, let's just get to the reasons. I'm not interested in hearing about her Atticus Finch father's role in all of this. At any rate, to just further detail some of the constructive value from the book. Just a few quick notes, and then folks, if they have any details that they would like to share. This first one, Christianity, made a appearance in the text, of course. This is a black family where they were trying to work out the situation with getting these ugly contracts. I know some of this is a little convoluted, but I hope folks can grasp basically. So number one, they mark up the price of the house. So if it's worth $8,000, they would go and charge black people $16,000, $20,000, just astronomical. And so then you maybe get a low down payment, or maybe not. Sometimes you have a huge down payment. You make your monthly payments, and they're so high, you miss one payment, and you could lose everything. The down payment plus everything that you've paid. And as she said, there are people, you could have paid $8,500 on a $9,000 property. You miss one payment, or they cheat you or what have you, and lose everything. Okay, so this is one black family that was trying to fight back against all of this. Joanna Williams, Mary Lee Stevenson, and Bertha and Lawrence Richards found no way to move forward. Bertha said that after Mo Foreman messed up her family's life, they fought till they couldn't. All of them went into bad health. Lawrence had about three heart attacks. Bertha, however, ultimately came to terms with her family's financial and political loss. I feel sorry that they were so cruel to treat us like that. Nothing didn't go like we wanted it. We just felt sorry in the heart. That's it. Her family tried not to let the experience poison their lives. Joanna, Mary Lee, and Lawrence had no bitterness about their battles with Foreman, Bertha recalled, because they were Christians. The next anecdote, speaking of religion, the religion of white supremacy, this is on page 122. So this is talking about white people and their religious practices. So she writes, this is a white man. He's a Catholic minister. So Mr. Egan's politically engaged Catholic faith soon confronted a very different Catholic reality. It escaped few people's notice that the neighborhoods where whites harassed, bombed, and sometimes burned out black families were overwhelmingly Catholic. The Catholic Interracial Council even observed the use of parish halls for anti-racial meetings. Now, when they say anti-racial, what they mean is working against black people. So they should say, it should just say, using parish halls for racist meetings. As one CIC member noted, the mobs are entirely white, many of them Catholics. It seems that it has come to the point where Catholics believe our church condones and approves white supremacy. She has segregation, but that's what it is. White supremacy, the religion of white supremacy. The last one I'll read, she has a lot of really good anecdotes about racial showcasing and giving details about how white people can manipulate and get a black person to go out front. Like she talks about how they white people would get black people to go and speak against Dr. King when he came to Chicago in 66. They would say, oh, we don't want you here and you're not going to solve our problems. Get on out. They would do that. Or if it was other local black people who were trying to step up and do something about racism, that it was easy for whites to get sometimes a whole lot of black people to go out and run interference and mess all their stuff up. And some of the black people even knew that this was all white orchestrated. Really great examples of that. I think I'll give one more illustration if I can put hands on, that gives more detail about white people. Yeah, I'll give you one more detail about ignorant white people. And again, Mr. Fuller, when he says white people cannot be ignorant about racism or they will get in trouble with other white people, there are a lot of different illustrations of that. Just, you know, heads up and enjoy. So this is on page 90. She says, and she's talking about her father, and he's doing these lawsuits trying to fight for black people on these contracts. So as her father's lawsuits made their way through the courts, he continued to look for ways to inform black Chicagoans directly about the dangers of contract buying. Julio Vivas the executive director of the Greater Lawndale Conservation Commission, had closely followed the unfolding drama of my father's crusade against exploitative contract sales. In the summer of 1958, Vivas invited my father to address a GLCC-sponsored community meeting on the problem. Unfortunately, even so small a step as sponsoring a community meeting was too much for some commission members. Among those most passionately opposed to the gathering was board member Al Weinberg, perhaps because Weinberg was himself a contract seller. Weinberg and his attorney, Michael Calica, both highly irate, showed up at the GLCC offices shortly before my father was scheduled to speak and condemned the commission's action, inviting Mark Satter to discuss contract sales as destroying their business. Eager to participate to placate them, the board agreed to allow Calica and a savings and loan representative, Al Roper, to present their view as well. The forum was held on June 17, 1958. It was in some ways a great success. The neatly dressed, overwhelmingly black audience of 150 people listened with expressions of shock, concern, and anger as my father laid out the extraordinary price black Chicagoans paid for their exclusion from the legitimate mortgage market. He goes into the $1 million. I thought this was the one where he was, it was a group of white people. I read the wrong one. Make sure I get the correct one here, where it's the white people talking about, because they were, it was a group of white people that tried to have a meeting to encourage allowing black people to move in and have these residents. Let's see. If I do not nab it quickly, I'll go ahead and just get to the phone lines. But she has some really good quotes where white people are just spilling the beans. Okay, here we go. Here we go. So this is on page 126. Building on this less than enthusiastic mandate, Alinsky's representatives set out to create a community organization that would encourage residents, black and white, to work together to prevent the decay of their neighborhood. The task took enormous energy and physical courage. Mansour Egan experienced the risk firsthand. He gave a talk to a Southwest Side block club that was in the immediate vicinity of St. Justin Martyr, where he had been a much-loved pastor. When the man who invited Egan realized that he would be advocating integration, Egan recalled he went to the bathroom and you could hear him retching. He knew he would probably be fired. At the end of Egan's talk, four large men, fellows I'd married or baptized their children, quickly hustled him out of the door. "You better get out of the neighborhood, Father," they told him. "If I'd been totally foreign to the community," Egan recalled, "it would have been a bit worse." they go on, because some of the other white people go on to talk about how they would have sold property to black people, but they were just like, "Oh man, there's no way that I can do this. I'm a white person. These are white people. Like I have a duty as a white person to, you know, not upset other white people and abide by the racist code." That's the gist of what they're saying. It might take me a bit too long to put my hands on it, so I'll go ahead and get folks who chimed in if they have any questions, comments that they would like to share about what they heard from the program and some of the responses that they got from Dr. Beryl Satter. Definitely appreciate 909's comment about not purchasing the book. I think I said that on Monday. I'll say it again. You should be able to get this book at the library. Like, it won awards and is should be easily accessible. Go to the library. If you got to purchase it, get a used copy. That way, you know, you don't have to be giving up white folks' money to get the information. It's a great read, just outstanding information, but we do not want to be purchasing white people's books. Right on. So with that, we will go ahead and hit the phone lines. If folks have comments they would like to share, feel free. If you didn't dial in with a question when Dr. Satter was with us, if you would like to chime in, if you have comments on what she had to share, you can do that as well. Well, I guess I'll give you one more before I get out. I'm flipping through. I had so many highlights. This is a big book and I had a lot of highlights. So it's a lot to sift through, to get to stuff. But, this is one, the past So they had all these brawls, right, to try to pass ordinance to improve housing and what have you. So they finally get around to passing one. The Chicago City Council passed the Fair Housing Ordinance on September 11th, 1963. It targeted real estate agents exclusively. The bill also prohibited panic peddling. Real estate agents were not to pressure people into selling their homes at a reduced price because of claims of loss of value due to the present or prospective entry of persons of any particular race. Enforcement was left to the Commission of Human Relations, which was given the right to initiate complaints against ordinance violators. Instead of acting on this power, though, the CHR focused on facilitating conciliation between aggrieved individuals and real estate brokers. At most, it threatened to revoke a discriminating or panic-peddling real estate broker's license. By 1967, the CHR had recommended the suspension of a broker's license in exactly one case. It involved a black real estate agent who was accused of panic-peddling after he sold a home on a white block to a black family. To pass even this anemic fair housing bill, Mayor Daley was forced to use all his political capital. Instead of the usual 49-1 city council vote, the ordinance passed by a vote of 30-16. The loyal alderman whom Daley chose to help draft the bill, James C. Murray, initially resisted the mayor's pressure to act as one of its sponsors. Murray ultimately decided that the fair housing bill was the right thing to do to relieve the housing pressure that blockbusters exploited, but his constituents never forgave him. "This guy would be a great alderman if he wasn't such a nigger lover," said one. Angry whites picketed his home and deluged him with threatening phone calls. "People would call and say they are going to throw acid in my mother's face." Murray's son recalled, "My brothers had police bodyguards watching them. The situation left Murray distraught. My family's gone through hell," he told the press. He was voted out of office at the next election. There are tons. There's so many anecdotes like this where white people, they weren't even trying to do anything to help black people. They just got accused, or it looked like that they were doing something that was going to benefit black people, and white people flipped. If you are a white person and you're ignorant about racism, you can believe white people will let you know immediately when you have done something wrong. And I'll stop there. Everyone who dialed in, you should be with us. If you have any comments, feel free to chime in. Oh, man. Well, wait a minute. I didn't look at the switchboard, so we had to do this the other way. The people that dialed in who did not speak when Dr. Satter was here, because it seems like there could be a lot of them, you all will get to go first. So all the people that dialed in who have not had an opportunity to speak at all, if you have anything you would like to share, your line should be open. Feel free.
May I be heard?
Yes.
Hi, this is Lady calling from New York. Just with learning all of this information, it's so daunting. I don't know what the remedy could be, because I know these things are still occurring today, whether it be with home loans, car loans, just any type of living. Black people are prey to white supremacy, and I don't know how or what should be done to, as far as the property, to just not fall victim to this racism and to this discrimination. I don't know if anyone has any suggestions. Should black people just be, you know, doing what they have to do, paying everything out in cash when they want to buy a home, you know, letting the kids stay with them a little bit longer while they get their careers off the ground, so that they can, you know, make a large lump sum on purchasing a home versus them, you know, 21 or 18 when they're done with college, just being, you know, starting to pay rent and things. I don't know. I'm just trying to kind of think of how this could be, you know, is there a remedy for this? Is there a resolve or a strategy that could be implemented? So, I don't know. I'd like to hear some feedback. I'll mute my line.
I don't know. Your question just reminded me of this was on Atlanta Black Star's front page today. Mass eviction of black tenants in L.A. serves as a reminder of the ugliness of gentrification, where they're talking about all these black people. It looks like they're going to be booted in the very near future in Los Angeles. So that just to your point that this is an ongoing everyday matter. Any of the folks that have a hand up who did not get to speak when Dr. Satter was on the program, if you had a question, comment, or wanted to respond to the question that was just posed? Any of the other folks that just dialed in didn't get a chance to ask a question, call her at 9400, or looks like somebody else might be on the flash phone. Do y'all have any comments, questions you want to get in?
Yeah, can I be heard? There you go.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. With regards to the place where I work, we are a government agency and we accept taxation. If a house is built or modified, we calculate the taxes that it is. And so for the county. And yeah, you have people who are immigrants who can't even write their name. I mean, literally cannot write their name. They have more property, it seems, than black people. And you have developers who are going in and who are targeting black people, getting their property, and they're developing it, but it's all legal. And what we have to do is we do have to move as a group. And that's and so long as we're not doing anything legal, we have to move as a group. They have actuary scientists. They can tell you probably how many heart attacks that one man, he said his family had. They can calculate it that cold accurately. And because they can calculate it that cold accurately, they know exactly what they're doing. And they target us. That's the reason. I mean, they can target anybody, but they're targeting us. And what we have to do is we have to move as a group. And we have, and that's the reason why our churches are significant. The government knows that from our churches, our places of worship is where our leaders come from. So, of course, they're going to put a lot of people there. I mean, that's obvious. But we're going to have to move in such a way that we bypass everything. And we have to understand, you know, who would be the people, what type of people would be the black people who would try and stop us, like the lay members and other people like that. We have to understand that, and we have to make a plan. And a plan, and we just move on the plan. And the plan has to be legal. Nobody can be able to stop us, and we just continue to move on the plan. So we can have property, but we do have to have a critical mass of education where people understand what's going on. And that's all I have to say. I'll mute my mic. Thank
you. There are other folks who dialed in that didn't get an opportunity to share or didn't question Dr. Satter, anybody else who has a hand up who didn't get to speak already?
Gus, that's me. I just had to call back in.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. We might have got everybody. I think we might have nabbed everybody. I will assume. If anybody else, regardless whether you spoke or not, if you had comments you wanted to get in about what you heard or the question on the table, you can feel free. I will say for the record, though, I would be ecstatic to never hear the term boule on this program again. I have no idea what that is. We are in a system of white supremacy. The problem is white people, as I have never heard a black person say that they are quote unquote boule. I might even chalk that up to just name calling, because you're supposed to be calling people what they want to be called, not assigning titles that you want to call people. And as I said, I've never heard a person say that they're part of the boule. So that might even be name calling if we're saying that such and such is in the boule. But I would be perfectly ecstatic to never hear that term on this program again.
If you want to talk to us in private, we can. And if not, then, you know, you like you said, you need to be forgiving and give black people a wide acceptance. I've not name-called anyone. and you can't claim that I've done such a thing, because I've not done it. But if you want to talk to me, sir, in private, we can certainly do that.
Other folks have anything to say, or is everybody content?
I think the point where she said that it could be argued both ways, and then you gave another option, the fact that, you know, if you so-called, you know, inform or educate these white people that, you know, just don't know what's going on, you know what I'm saying, that, you know, that they won't change. That was a good point, man. You know what I'm saying? But I mean, that was a good point. And I was just thinking, man, a lot of times these conversations, you know, if I pretty much, you know, it's just, if I only give you two options, you know what I'm saying, in the conversation, we get tricked like that a lot, man. You know, I had a, I just don't have it now because I'm doing something, but it was all of these lists of tricks, you know what I'm saying, as far as, you know, with grammar and conversations, all these tricks that white people come up with to basically confuse us. I mean, it was you know, not just logical fallacies, but like these long techniques of just, you know, these long and studied techniques of basically, you know, misinforming us, man. I mean, it was like just on a, you know, like PhD level, you know what I'm saying? And I just seen a lot of cases where we fall into that easily, man, because we don't really have a grasp on that kind of stuff. So we'll end up, you know, I don't know, I just thought that was interesting, you know. But I think the history is good. Would you agree that we shouldn't be buying this book, though? Or you think it's worth it? I know you have, you know, pretty much stance on that type of stuff, but you kept saying we should get it. But
definitely, I think it's worth a read. I mean, you could get that library and read it. Used bookstores, I'm sure, would probably have a copy. I get the impression this book probably sold quite a bit because it won some awards and that sort of thing. It was on book TV. So I definitely think you could get it without having to pay for it if you just want to read. If it's one of those where if you do read it and you think it's got enough good detail that you want to have it in your personal library, I was just encouraged to get a used copy. You should be able to get a used copy for less than $10, maybe even less than $5, depending on, you know, where you look. And I mean, you can get a good copy that's not all raggedy and falling apart, good quality set that you can, you know, keep in your personal library. But definitely we shouldn't be financing white folks to write about the abuse of black people.
Did you catch when she said they knew that they could make a killing?
Oh yeah, she says that like in the book. Like I don't mean like the one that I quoted in my Obama library article. She says that it was like. She uses the metaphor, I guess I could pull it up to get the exact quote, but basically she uses the metaphor that it's like going on safari, this selling these exploitative contracts to black people in Chicago, that it was like going to hunt lions and tigers in the jungle. That's another metaphor that she used to describe it. So I think it's there. I think it's absolutely accurate, and it's literal or figuratively. This is killing black people, and this is making a sport out of it, and white people enjoying going doing so.
And it, you know, it's deep, man. Like people were living in all these crazy conditions, man. I mean, still to this day, like you was talking about in L.A., man, it's just you know, roaches, rats, and burning down, and you know, man, it's just man. I don't know what to say, man. It's just like, you know, she wrote this history, but like I was asking as far as like a white person, because man, they had this white person on KPFK that was this, you know, anti-racist, and you know, they were going down the list of their resume, and it was just like being an anti-racist organizer, or it was just a part of the just a one thing, you know, you check the list. Okay, I did this. I did the racism thing. I did the feminist thing. The animal. I mean, you know what I mean? Like, it's just it's an incredible work. You know what I'm saying? And I think that, you know, white people will read it with no problem. It's academic. You know what I'm saying? They like, well, you know, they can appreciate the history, and that's it. They're not you know, a white person can write it and still speak on behalf of white people after all this abuse, and say that they really didn't know and this and that, and then come on the program and, you know, when pressed, oh, it can be argued both ways. It's please, man, like, I've been seeing black people fall left and right, man, you know what I'm saying, this year. And we really got to understand some of this stuff. How would you recommend people share this type of, yeah, I mean, of course, with the show, man, but people have low attention spans, man, and they can't really put this stuff together. They don't realize that the stuff that they're going through now, man, has a long history. I don't know, man. If you can address anything that I said, I know it's kind of incoherent, but...
You just try to catch people as they're receptive. I know, like you were saying, people have short attention spans. Or this is not the NBA finals. You can go watch, you know, LeBron James run around and do stuff. But I mean, I think it gives a lot of pertinent information in terms of the things that you're looking at now and the predicament that black people are, the predicament that we're in, black people. When you get this information, I think it makes it so much clearer. I think it, at least in my opinion, it should help with the way we treat other black people, the way we think about black people, the way we think about white people, and understanding the levels of their treachery and how what that has done to us as it's been compiled over generations. But I think just catching folks when they're receptive, when you don't have to try and hit them with this, you know, with this whole big program to say, listen to this, or even this book, because this book is kind of long. I don't know if you want to, you know, drop a 500-page book, but I say, hey, read this, you know, dense academic book about loans and mortgages and all that and stuff that happened to black people 75 years ago. I don't know that, you know, a lot of people would be willing to accept that. But just talking about some of these ideas, I think if you have it, if you heard some of the tidbits that stood out that you understand, I think most people that you could get 5 minutes where they might be receptive to hearing, discussing ideas for 5 minutes and just try to plant that seed. I think we talked about that before. And then if this is someone that you're in contact with on a regular basis, if it comes back up, well, you can kind of revisit it, let them know that there's material out there that can kind of help explain some of this stuff, the history of some of this information, and just take kind of baby steps with it. I think that's why some of the people, they put out little 4-minute videos of Mr. Fuller. That way you don't have to sit down and read his big 300-page code book, or, you know, listen to him talk for an hour or 2 hours or whatever the case may be. You can just get a little bit, 4 minutes, think about it, and you come back, you know, down the road when you might be willing to invest more. But I definitely say make that effort, as I know, you know, 909 and a lot of you all do make that effort to reach out. And just when they're receptive, you know, just look for 5 minutes. You don't have to get the whole ball of wax, but just a little bit of information, and then see if they if there's a zeal to come back and bring it up again. But yeah, I understand it's difficult, you know, trying to get this out to folks.
Hey, good. Yeah, have you heard? Oh, go ahead.
I already spoke. Go ahead.
No, I have to. You go ahead, ladies first.
Well, then what I suggest is that, yes, that's for like the general, your idea was a good idea for the general public, but you still need people who are in the field have a better understanding. And so, and what we have to do is we have to put forth, you know, a plan, just like you have an independent contemporary code book, you have to have some type of code book on that. So those people who are going to be in the field will have a better understanding. And those people who want to go ahead and buy a house or buy other types of property, hopefully, like commercial property and things like that, which is cheaper and actually gives a greater return than even a house. What you can do is you can have those people then have the code book. But we have to codify every part of our existence so we can be codified, so we can move forward. And we can't, and when we do this, it's not being mean or trying to be overbearing. It's that we're trying to explain how the world works and how that we can best survive in it. And not, of course, what we want to do is establish justice. And establishing justice, we have to raise ourselves to the point that if we're the persons who understand that justice needs to be established, we're going to have power so we can establish justice. And part of that power will be economic power. And so we would have to write it, have it written down, and it would have to be codified. I'd like to know what the other people think about this idea. Because we could talk about these people all day long, about this person, this book, and this person. We have a graph. We have the book. We're writing down what they do, and we have to write a codified response. Essentially what I'm saying. I'll mute myself. Thank you.
Was there another female caller? I thought I heard she wanted to respond.
Yes, this is Lady again. Thank you, Gus. I totally agree that these things should be codified, and people who are experts are people who are, you know, they may not be a real estate agent or a broker, but they have been successful in acquiring properties and managing them, should come together with this. But I'd like to really say that I'm trying not to be angry, but it really angers me that these white persons will write all these books, great detail, historical accuracies, and they never have a solution. They never even attempt to give a remedy. And to me, that is practicing racist white supremacy to the utmost. It's just like, hey, look what's happening to you guys. Yes, white people, my fellow white people do this to black people, and then it's just it. And I'm, like I said, I'm trying not to get too upset with it, but and because it is some valuable information that is within this writing, but it's just like, okay, what are you going to do to stop it? You know so much about it. What are you going to do to help stop it? And they won't, because that's another form of practicing racism. It's just astonishing to me how they kind of just sell through that. I'll mute my line.
Hang on. We have done our three. Unless the male caller, I think you were trying to get in before. If you have something brief you want to get in, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, Gus. I'm real quick, man. I'm hitting the wall with it, and maybe you can help me out, because you know, like I said, I listen to Neely Fuller. You know, when he talks about people who understand racism, white supremacy, you got to understand it, or you only be confused. Then he got a quote that say people who have the ability to eliminate racism do not have the will to do so, and the people who have the will to do so do not have the ability. And so I'm hitting a wall, and I'm trying to follow the logic, and it's like, if we trying to end this system of racism, white supremacy, and we're not trying to, and we have no ability to have the power or to incorporate white people to help in this, and logically, why would white people want to help in this? How can we end this system? How can this system ever end if we don't have the power to make it end? You talk about economic power, and I think about Wall Street, the Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. These were black people that had wealth, and white supremacy ended it. Every black leader that we've had been killed, and we got to where we are right now. So I'm hitting a wall, and I'm just, you know, I love your show and I listen to it, but I'm just logically, I don't see how this system will ever end if we don't have white people, the most powerful white people, to help end this system. And if they don't, logically, why would they want to? So, I mean, I'm confused, Gus. Help me out.
No, that's kind of a, or it might be challenging because we are at the end of the program. I don't think. I don't think people are going to be able to pull me into doing an extra 30 or 20 minutes today because I have other assignments and things. I can only say my response to that is having heard Mr. Fuller a lot, and it is daunting. I know it's, you know, hearing what she presented today or Mr. Fuller and other people that talk about racism, it can be demoralizing. It can seem like, my God, this is, you know, not solvable. This is not fixable. This just seems really dire. But I know from Mr. Fuller, he said pretty consistently that, you know, thus far, black people, victims of racism, we have not demonstrated the ability to replace white supremacy with justice. That can change. And pretty consistently, when I hear him talk, that's why he does what he does. That's why he's writing the books. People can go to producejustice.com, can hear him on Talktainment and what have you, that we can make the necessary corrections, improvements, so that we develop the ability, the will, to solve this problem. And I absolutely think that can happen. I think some of the things you all were talking about in terms of getting more information, if that's about economics, if that's about being able to not just acquire property, but being able to actually maintain it once you get it so that white people don't come and steal it back from you in a year or 2 years or 2 days. Once you get it, just acquiring more information, even acquiring more information about our enemies, so that you know more of the traps that are going to be set to mess you up, whether you're a property owner or if you are a business owner or whatever the case may be. But just getting more information so that we'll be more successful at countering what they're trying to do. But for me, I don't think it has to be about getting white people. In fact, I don't think that's going to happen. I think we would be better just, we're not going to have white people's help. We can do this, meaning black people. We can solve this problem. If we could not solve this problem, white people would not be harassing us and all of the other black people, even some black people that we name call and talk bad about, who say that they're working against racism. White people wouldn't be harassing them. White people wouldn't be molesting them and putting them in jail, like what you're hearing from Assata Shakur. All of these different things would not be happening if white people didn't think that we could develop the will, the ability to solve this problem. So I think it's simply a matter of recognizing that, getting a better grasp of what it means to be white, and then just trying to learn as much constructive information as possible that's going to benefit other black people, and then even sharing that information so that black people are getting a better understanding of the world, a better understanding of constructive information, things that are going to help them solve problems, and a better understanding that war is being waged against us. I think just a combination of that, I know it's kind of quick, but I think those are some of the things right there that will help push us in that direction. And I think once you start doing those things, able to solve problems, getting more information, figuring out ways to neutralize some of white people's racist tactics, I think that in and of itself, I think that nourishes black self-respect and it encourages that belief that, yes, this problem can be solved. We individually, everyone listening to this program right now, can do things to help us solve this problem. It's a matter of time, a matter of putting in the work and just sticking with that process of being codified, learning more and being dedicated to getting it done. But I absolutely think it's going to happen. Just a matter of time. With that, as I said, I'm not.
Thank you, Gus.
For sure. And folks can bring this back up on the Saturday program if they want to ponder on it, bring up some ideas, hash it around. We'll have time this set. That's what the compensatory calling is for. 909, do you want to get a last statement before we wrap things up?
You killed it. That's just what I was going to say. We don't have the power right now because we're not respecting ourselves. But, you know, that's how we're going to get the power. You feel what I'm saying? Yeah, that's all I was going to say. We just don't have it right now because we're not respect is more powerful than a nuclear bomb, like it wasn't said. So, you know, that's what I was going to say. We just don't have the power now because once we start respecting ourselves, we're going to have mad power.
For sure. Reason she was denied tenure, in my opinion, that right there, if white people thought, you know, this problem could be solved and it was racism, white supremacy is insurmountable, who cares? Fine. Have Dr. Wells get your little tenure at your little HBCU and teach until your heart is content. Black people are ignorant and stupid and this problem can't be solved. That's the logic they would use. That's not the way white people operate. It was immediately make sure that she doesn't have access, the opportunity to inform other black people. And I see the same logic play out. I absolutely think it's, and I think just that alone, I think I can wrap right there. I think just that alone, believing it, understanding that that is true, and not just wishing or hoping, but really understanding that, yes, this problem is going to be solved. It is a matter of time. And white people know this problem can and is going to be solved. That's why they're doing all of this stuff, keeping black people on the move and dislocated so they don't have property and homes where they can be comfortable, where they can think about this problem, where they can respect themselves, respect other black people. That's why they work against this all the time, because they know it is just a matter of time. I could be in error, but again, we'll have opportunity to address this this weekend. Folks want to bring it up for the compensatory call-in. Again, we'll be back on Thursday. Asada Shakur, another black person who I think believe this problem is going to be solved. 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, 6th study session. We should have two more, and we're all done with Asada Shakur. Compensatory call-in will be this Saturday at 9 p.m. Eastern. 8 p.m. Central and 6 p.m. Pacific. We'll be looking forward to hearing from folks then. I hope it was constructive. Again, don't purchase the book. Go to the library. If you got to buy it, get a used copy. We don't want to finance white folks, but I would definitely recommend reading Family Properties. I think it has a lot of information that you'll get a better understanding of white supremacy, white people in general. Definitely, if you're a Chicago resident, you should read this book. I think you'll get a lot of information about your area, your town, whether you grew up there or whether you just been living there for a short period of time. But Family Properties, Race, Real Estate, and the Exploitation of Black America, Economic Terrorism. She did co-sign on that. Economic Terrorism Against Black People. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in. We will be back in about 48 hours. I again encourage sobriety, the system of white supremacy. They are looking to terrorize black people any and all the time. It's one of the best things that we could do financially and just making sure that we minimize problems. We are never behind the wheel intoxicated. We even give pause to being intoxicated if you're going to be a passenger in a vehicle. Even if you're going to be a pedestrian on a scooter, I don't want to be under the influence just because I don't want to make it easy for racist terrorists like the officer down in McKinney, Texas, or Daniel Holtzclaw, Daniel Pantaleo, any number of these race soldiers that have brutalized and maimed black people. You don't want to make their job any easier when you step out of your residence. This is a battlefield. Racists have turned the entire planet into war for them against black people. So we should just keep that in mind every time that we go out. I think it would be best to not consume alcohol at all. But if you are going to do so, be codified, not around white people, and even being careful about the non-white people that you're around. Because unfortunately, a lot of times victims, we get intoxicated and just unnecessary conflict, unnecessary problems. We can squash all of that. Just dump the intoxicants, dump the alcohol, and be about sobriety, where you can be lucid, clear thinking to try to come up with concepts and ideas to solve this problem. That being said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of racism. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Context of White Supremacy signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
no
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Man, I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.